Hello, everyone, and welcome to Huntington Bank Stadium. It is a nice, cool, chilly October day where we have Nebraska Cornhuskers going up against the Minnesota Golden Gophers. The Nebraska Cornhuskers are 3-4 with a 1-3 record in the Big Ten, while the Golden Gophers are 3-2 with a 1-1 record in the Big Ten. Their last meeting, Minnesota won 24-17 at Nebraska, and their overall Minnesota's overall record versus Nebraska is 34-25-2. I'm here with Jay Sander and Jack Bartlett. And Jay, obviously there's been some mix-ups with running backs this year. What are you seeing out of running backs today?
So 2 weeks ago in the game against the Boilermakers, sadly Trey Potts had to leave the game early, and he has been now listed as out for the year. He did a fantastic job filling in for Mo, but now we're going to have to rely on the number three running back in the system. That's going to means we're going to be looking to Marquise Irving as the probable new number one. He was a consensus four-star recruit in high school and ranked the number nine running back in the nation. He is a true freshman, so it's going to be really interesting to see how he handles being on the big stage. In the game against Colorado, he had 15 carries for 89 yards. And in the last two games, he's rushed 10 times for 23 yards. The other running backs the Gophers are going to be relying on are Kai Thomas, Cam Wiley, and Bryce Williams. Kai Thomas is also a consensus four-star recruit, and he was the number 25th ranked high school running back in the nation. Along with all these running backs who are going to have to fill in and they're going to have to step up, the Gophers have had fantastic run defense this season. Opponents have only been able to average 77 yards rushing yards a game against the Gopher rushing defense, and in the last three games, they have only given up 80 total rushing yards. Colorado had negative 19 rush yards, Bowling Green was held to 22, and Purdue only had 77.
Hello, Jack Bartlett here. I'm just going to talk a little bit about the Nebraska Cornhuskers and how well they've been playing against ranked teams. So Nebraska's 3-4. They've lost three games in the Big Ten, but they lost by 7 to number 4 ranked Oklahoma when Spencer Rattler and their offense was firing on all cylinders. They lost to a late field goal by number 8 ranked Michigan. They held them close for the entire game. And they lost by 3 to number 10 Michigan State on another tight game. So Nebraska is a lot better than their record really shows. And it's especially because of their offense. Their offense is one of the best in the nation at producing long plays. They're top 5 nationally and in the Big Ten in producing 20 to 80 plus yard plays. Their offense is top 4 in the Big Ten in rushing, passing, total offense, and scoring, even while playing those three ranked teams. And so Minnesota's defense, especially against Ohio State, was hurt by those long plays. Every one of their touchdowns was longer than 30 yards. So I think a key for the Gophers' defense especially is to be playing some deep safety to try and slow down that red-hot Cornhusker passing offense.
Yeah, so what are you guys looking for today out of sorry, Jack. You got more. What are you looking at with the red zone offense and defense?
Yeah, so the Minnesota red zone offense and defense have been very good this year. Both are third in the Big Ten with a 94% conversion rate on offense and a 78% conversion rate allowed on defense. So if we do end up getting down the field, look for the Gophers offense to punch it in against a Nebraska defense that is allowing points on 89% of their red zone opportunities, whereas their offense is only scoring 79% of the time. So especially with those deep balls that are inevitably going to happen throughout the game, I think that the Minnesota red zone offense and defense, it'd be great if they could work effectively.
Yeah, and Jay, we're going to what are you looking at for the keys of the game today?
For today's game, we're going to be looking for a lot more play calling diversity. This season, the Gophers have been extremely rush heavy, and with now Mo and Trey Potts being out for this season and having to rely on a lot of young and somewhat inexperienced running backs, I do not think that a rush heavy playbook is going to bode super well. So what we're hoping to see is just some more unique play calling, trying to get some RPOs in there. In the homecoming game against Bowling Green, we saw Cole Kramer rush for a touchdown, And we're just trying to keep the Huskers on their toes. We don't want them to start, you know, being able to predict our plays. We don't want them to be making stops. We're just going to be trying to be doing some unique play calling and really just, you know, trying to stay on top of the offensive game. Another big key is the Gophers' passing game. Passing has been one aspect of their game they have been struggling with, and they've been averaging 142 passing yards a game. So the big key for the Gophers to take advantage of their passing game is for the O-line to step up and give Tanner the time to find his guys and to hit them down the field.
Yeah, I definitely think Tanner needs to start playing like one of the better quarterbacks in the Big Ten, which is what he's supposed to be. We need prime Tanner, that's for sure. Jack, anything else to add?
Yeah, I would add one more thing about mixing up the offense. Maybe run a bit more I formation running back looks. We've been running a lot of Tanner Morgan in the shotgun with the running back next to him, especially on the third and short, even fourth and short opportunities. I'd like to see some more I formation with Co-Keefe to possibly put in as a fullback to just give the running back some time and some speed to get going forwards rather than having them go side to side, especially on those short plays where you just have to fall forward for a couple yards to get a key first down in the game.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so Minnesota's coming off a bye week. They've had time to rest. They've had time to prepare. They got a Big Ten game right now. They got a few more the next few weeks. So they're looking to get a big win to really gain some momentum and bring it home. And with that, we thank you for listening to Radio K Sports, and the broadcast will begin shortly.
Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen. It's Radio K Sports live from Huntington Bank Stadium. My name is Trask Angel alongside Connor Mockney, Jason Ruttman, an assortment of others who you heard from in the pregame program and will continue to hear from for the rest of the game today. We have the Minnesota Golden Gophers hosting the Nebraska Cornhuskers. We are ready to go here in Huntington Bank Stadium. The Gophers have won the toss and elected to kick towards the student section. Connor, what are you looking for in today's game?
I'm looking for a big passing attack today. The Gophers really have to get this passing attack going. When your leading receiver has 169 yards on the year through five games, that's not very good. So I'm looking for a big pass attack and some strong defense.
The Gophers will send the kickoff and through the back of the end zone. So the Nebraska Cornhuskers will start from their own 25. This Minnesota Gold Gopher defense, one of the top defenses in the country against the run. We'll see what they can do against the explosive pass offense of the Cornhuskers and Martinez.
As you noted, Adrian Martinez, a starting quarterback for Nebraska, he's their big playmaker. As we noted a little bit earlier before this game, he is their leading rusher in attempts, and he's also a really big pass threat. He can beat you multiple ways.
Martinez in shotgun. He'll hand off to his right. He's going to fake the handoff and run outside, and he's swallowed up by the Gopher defense. He'll lose a yard on the play, and starting from the right hash, it'll be second and 11 for the Nebraska Cornhuskers.
And that last stat that you saw there, that you heard from there, was actually from Jason Ruttman earlier in the pregame, so a nice little nugget there from him.
Thomas Rush on the tackle, among others. Martinez in shotgun. He's going to fake the handoff, look to pass, pocket collapses over the middle, and it's no catch out of the hands of number 11, Austin Allen, the tight end. And multiple Gophers in coverage, and just like that, it's going to be third and long for Nebraska.
Looked like Jack Gibbons was in there on the hit late after that ball got deflected by the receiver of Nebraska and ain't falling incomplete.
Nebraska with trips left, a single receiver on the far side. Martinez stands in shotgun. The Gophers with six in the box. Three down linemen. Martinez clapping. The student section loud. The snap, looking to pass. Throws over the middle, and no good. It's going to be fourth down, and the Golden Gophers force a three and out for Nebraska to start this one.
Really nice way to start this game on defense here. Not allowing Nebraska to quiet the fans on their first drive. They've got a good amount of fans here, so not getting them involved early on here is a pretty good sign.
Brock Anixed for the Golden Gophers to receive the punt. Good snap, kicks away. Gophers don't bring pressure. This one to the Nebraska sideline, caught at the 36. Anixed will shuffle his way to the 39, so the Gophers will start on the far hash to begin their offensive possession. Connor, the Gophers win 2 weeks ago. They're coming off the bye week. Some criticism from fans, media members, that maybe we're not passing the ball enough. Do you think they come out heavy with the pass, or are they going to try to rely on that run game still?
I think they're going to, at least they should try to come out heavy with the pass. I know the run game has been pretty big for them so far this year, but when you're down your top two running backs now for the rest of the year, and you have a running back by committee, you kind of have to use the pass quite a bit more.
Gophers in shotgun. Two receivers near side. A tight end on either end. Four down linemen for the Huskers. Morgan fakes a handoff. Throws to the flat. It's caught. Turning his legs. He'll be stood up near a first down. It was number seven, Chris Ottman-Bell, the redshirt senior. And he's got one throw and one catch to start this one off. It's going to be second and one.
Just like we talked about trying to use the pass game, first play of the game is a nice little screen play or type and a little off the RPO and getting a good chunk of yards there. If they can do that consistently throughout this game, they should have good offensive performance.
Morgan in shotgun, a receiver to the near side, one out by himself on the far side. Nebraska with a safety over the top. They're going to motion a man across and Coquette. He'll settle behind the line. Gophers will hand it off. Up the seam, falling forward. First down, Minnesota. It's number 21, Bryce Williams with the carry.
It'll be good to see him We haven't seen much of Bryce Williams so far this year. So now, as we talked about with the two top running backs out, it'll be good to get him some touches and maybe vary it up with guys like Irvin, Wiley, and Kai Thomas.
On the near side, it's Brown Stevens and number 16, Dylan Wright. Single receiver far side, Kokeef, the tight end stacked to the left of Morgan. Morgan in shotgun with Williams to his left. 13 minutes left to play in the first quarter, 0-0 here in Minneapolis. Two safeties over the top for the Huskers. Fakes the handoff. Morgan double pumps, fires across the middle, and as he's hit, he drops it. That ball was intended for number 16, Dylan Wright. Briefly in his hands and then popped out on contact.
Tough little play there. There were a lot of Huskers in the area in the vicinity of that throw. Plus the little pump fake might have caused, you know, a little bit of a hesitation there from Morgan. Might have caused that drop.
Cam Tyler Britt, the safety for Nebraska, with the hit and forcing the incompletion. Gophers lined up now, second and 10 from the middle of the field. Going towards the student section here at Huntington Bank Stadium. The sun is out, not a cloud in the sky. The snap, fakes the handoff, slant over the middle, caught! And it's gonna be just short of a first down. Wrapped up immediately on the catch is number 7, Chris Ottman-Bell, his second catch of the day. And they are gonna be calling it a first down. So the Gophers on their way. It'll be first and 10 from the Nebraska 38.
Nice little play there, another slant over the middle. And so far we've seen Chris Ottman-Bell with two catches already on this drive, so it's gonna be really important to make sure that he gets involved in this game.
Two receivers near side, Kokeef, the tight end stacked on the right. Morgan shotgun, Williams to his right. Huskers with four linemen, two safeties over the top. Morgan's gonna make some adjustments. He's got three to snap, he's gotta hurry. He claps, ball gets away. They're gonna hand off to Williams. Williams hitting the backfield. He's gonna avoid another defender and get himself to the 34-yard line along the Gopher sideline. And it'll be second and about 6 for Minnesota.
Very nice job there, at least getting some positive yards. A Nebraska defender met Williams in the backfield there, but he was able to escape and get a nice solid chunk of 5 on that play when it could have been negative.
Brady Boyd checking into the game for Minnesota. A receiver near side, 2 on the far side. Morgan in shotgun, Williams to his left. Morgan looks sideline, on the right hash, snaps, hands to Williams. Williams with the seam off tackle, breaks the tackle, and turns his way to another first down on the left hash. First down, Minnesota.
This is a really nice job. We've seen Williams the entire time on this drive so far as the running back one, and so it'll be good to see if he can continue this throughout the game.
Kokeef checking off the field for Minnesota. Minnesota's gonna go two receivers either side. Williams still stands to the left of Morgan in shotgun. First and 10 from the Husker 25, left hash. Looks sideline, 10 to snap, 11 minutes in the first quarter. Minnesota fakes the handoff, throws to Ottman-Bell in the flats, makes a move, falls forward to the 20-yard line in front of the Nebraska sideline. Second and 5, Minnesota.
Looks like Chris Ottman-Bell has been the main target. He's caught all three passes thrown to him so far, and so it looks like he's going to be a big part of the offense today.
The 5'10", 190-pound freshman running back, Marquise Irving, into the game for Bryce Williams. Two receivers either side. Morgan in shotgun with Irving to his left. Nebraska with three backers, two safeties. Throwing to the flats. Irving has it. Irving makes a man miss. Irving gets to the 10-yard line. Flag comes late. We wait and see what we have.
You think it could be on a hit?
It might be a hold here on Minnesota. Flag lies at the 19, just under the numbers. And it's gonna be an illegal block in the back on the Golden Gophers. It's called against number 88. That's Brevin Span Ford, who just checked into the game. And so it erases a first down run for Irving and will back Minnesota up to the Nebraska 29.
Not a good play there, especially when you have a good play to set you up in the red zone. You don't want to get, you know, these starting to pile up.
Doubles for Minnesota. Irving to the left of Morgan. in shotgun. Snaps, fakes the handoff. Morgan looking, time to throw. Has a man open! It's going to be short of the first, but it's caught and ringed in for 13 yards. It's number 22, Mike Brown-Stevens.
Nice little play there. They found a good seam, and Morgan had time in the pocket to throw, which is always important, so we're going to need a big game from this offensive line, which so far looks like they've done a pretty good job.
9:45 remaining in the first quarter, still scoreless here in Minneapolis. The Nebraskas go three and out, and Minnesota still on their first offensive drive. Third and one from the Nebraska 16. Near hash, everybody still in the sun.
Cole Kramer's in,
and it's going to be 12. Cole Kramer in at quarterback. He's trying to make some adjustments, and the Gophers have to take a timeout as the play clock dwindles down. So the Gophers looking like they were maybe going to attempt some wildcat offense there in third and short. And with that, we will head to a media timeout, and it will give us our first opportunity to hear from some of our new Radio K members. And so again, we get to introduce another newbie to the team in Jay Sander, and we'll hear from Jay. He'll give us an update, and once he's done, stick around and we will be back momentarily. So Jay, welcome to Radio K Sports. I know you're on the pregame show, but what do you got for us?
Oh, thank you. I'm excited to be here. What I got for all y'all listening back at home is a Marquise Irving spotlight. As we brought up in the pregame, he is going to be the guy hoping to fill in for that running back one spot. So far, we've seen him with a couple carries this game. He's looked great out there. He'll be wearing number 4 for the Gophers. He's 5'10", 190 pounds. He's a true freshman, as mentioned in the pregame, which that is always very interesting to see when a true freshman is getting the starts and the looks that are going to be expected out of him. He calls Chicago his home, and he made his collegiate debut earlier this year against Miami of Ohio with 2 kick returns for 64 yards. But the interesting thing about Marquise Irving is when he was in high school, he received the nickname of Bucky, but of course, Bucky is the University of Wisconsin's mascot. And with all the pettiness we love to see as Gopher fans, his Gopher teammates have changed his name to Bucko because they could not stand to be saying Bucky throughout the whole season. So that is our spotlight on Marquise Irving, and we are hoping to get a great year out of him.
Awesome. Thank you very much, Jay, for joining us during the media timeout. We have approximately 60 seconds left of our media timeout, so we'll take this opportunity to mention what else, you know, Radio K Sports does. And not only do we do live play-by-play and, you know, for football and basketball, hockey, but we also have the Sports Hour podcast, which is hosted by Connor Mockney. And so once a week on Tuesdays, Connor, you know, they can check it out on Spotify, RadioK.org. Anything else that
Apple
we should
mention?
Yeah, Apple Podcast. Anything else we should mention about the podcast?
Well, we got some pretty big shows coming up. You know, we recently released our MLB playoff prediction show, which, good or bad, you know, some of these predictions here, a lot of our teams are out, but we have a lot of good things. We're rotating a lot of guests. We're gonna have some interviews coming up. We're working on that, so we got some really fun stuff planned for you guys.
Awesome, and with that, we're back out on the field, ready to go with just over 9 minutes remaining in the first quarter. The Gophers third and one from the Nebraska 16-yard line. Gophers on the near hash heading towards the student section into the sun. Still out there for the Gophers is number 12, Cole Kramer. They're going to snap. Cole's going to keep it himself. Hit at the line, but he's going to fall forward. It's a first down for Minnesota at the 14-yard line, and the Golden Gophers are nearing that end zone and nearing a touchdown, which have been hard to come by at some moments of the season.
Yes, they have. This offense has looked good so far, knock on wood. Hopefully they can finish off this drive, but it looks like they're going to be using Cole Kramer as that green line special that Seth Green used to run for years. So I think they finally found potentially that guy.
Morgan back into the game, Irving to his left. Trips to the left side, single receiver on the Gopher sideline. They'll look sideline with six to snap. Morgan's going to have to make adjustments. Three, two, one. He's not going to get it off. Yes, he does. He's going to hand to Irving. Irving is going to be hit at the line, maybe fall forward for two. And it'll be second down and about eight for Minnesota.
Fans were cheering there because one of the offensive linemen, John Michael Schmitz, was finishing about a 20-yard block into the end zone well after the play. So nice little effort there and appreciated by the student section.
And a correction there, Irving not on the run, but number eight, Kai Thomas, a redshirt freshman for the Golden Gophers. He checks out of the game, and Bryce Williams comes back into the game. Morgan in shotgun. Morgan.
It's Kramer.
Kramer's going to keep it himself. Kramer gets hit at the line and will spin forward for a gain of four or five. And the Gophers really active in the substitution, something we haven't seen a lot of this season.
Yeah, really mixing up their packages here in the red zone. And you're just trying to keep Nebraska's defense on their toes, maybe show them something that they didn't expect from, you know, preparing for this game.
So Kramer will stay out there. Brady Boyd is off. Williams will stay. Two receivers on the left side. Brevin Spann Ford, the tight end, is going to be the man stacked on the left side of the formation. 7:20 remaining. Third and three for Minnesota. Five on the line for Nebraska. They'll fake the handoff. Kramer keeps it himself. He's hit, and he is going to be short, about a yard short. So it's going to be fourth and one from the Nebraska five. Minnesota offense has not flinched. They'll make one substitution. And other than that, it looks like the Minnesota Golden Gopher offense is going to go for it. And the fans, with a rousing cheer of applause, agreeing with the call by PJ Fleck. It's going to be fourth and one. Kramer will stay out there with Williams to his right. He'll look sideline, 10 to snap, 6:30 in the quarter. Snap, fake the handoff, they throw, touchdown Minnesota! Number 88, Brevin Spann Ford with a falling catch in the corner. Wide open, touchdown, 6-0, Golden Gophers.
What a nice play design there. Kramer had run the ball every time he had taken a snap, and so this time he fakes the handoff, fakes a run, and then throws it up for a touchdown.
And we have a flag on the play. It is against the defense. It's going to be offsides called against number five, Cam Tyler Britt. And so it will be declined by the Gophers, and we will go ahead and kick an extra point. We're set. There's the whistle. And we await the snap. Snap, hold, and kick are all good. Minnesota leads the Nebraska Cornhuskers 7-0 with 6:33 remaining in the first quarter. Bryce Williams, your rushing leader for the Gophers with 17. Right now, the Nebraska rushing leader is Martinez with minus 1 yards. A good start for Minnesota. And with that, we head to a media timeout and we head to Jack Bartlett. Jack, welcome back to the broadcast team.
Yeah, Tress, thanks for having me. And as the Minnesota crowd chants the Minnesota after the score, I think that fourth and one play call, the confidence in PJ Fleck and the confidence in our new quarterback to throw that ball on fourth and one, I don't know if I've ever seen the Gophers do that this season.
Well, I think that goes back to a little bit what you guys talked about pregame and what Connor and I were talking about is there's been some criticism of this team of not being aggressive enough, not airing the ball out enough. And I think that shows that, hey, they recognize that maybe we've been a little too conservative, you know, running or kicking when we should be going for it. And it obviously pays off there. And, you know, so far, I think Minnesota has really looked dominant over this Nebraska team.
Yeah, exactly. And especially what surprised me is our use of Cole Kramer during that drive. He was mostly used as a third and short, fourth and short quarterback. And we saw that a couple times, and that was very effective. And I think using him as a good option quarterback, who obviously he just demonstrated that he can throw pretty well, even though that ball was slightly underthrown, a really good adjustment, and a good comeback for Brevin Spann Ford after the penalty that was called negated the first down.
Yeah, it will be interesting to see how Nebraska responds now and how the Gopher defense responds now. You get the three and out, have a really nice series. You know, what does Nebraska come out with now? Martinez was not able to run at all on that last series. They're known for the big play. Do they try to take some shots here, or are they going to be a little more conservative and just try to chew up some first downs?
Yeah, I think in terms of Nebraska's offense, I think they're going to start launching this drive especially. They want to get that score back quickly, and especially because that Gopher drive took the clock down to 6 minutes and 33 seconds with Morgan using all of the play clock coming down to 1 second in many times during the drive. I think that they're going to look to air it out, so I think Minnesota should definitely be playing one or two deep safety. I'd like to see them play some more zone and especially maybe play an extra linebacker if they see Nebraska's quarterback running more often.
Awesome. Well, thank you, Jack, very much for joining us on the media timeout. We have about 35, 40 seconds here before we resume the game after this timeout, and worth mentioning that we have opportunities for anyone to get involved, right? So if you're a student listening in right now, Radio K Sports is always looking for new people. I mean, if you've listened to any of the broadcasts or any of the podcasts this year, you've seen we have a lot of new people coming in, and it's been really fun to rotate a bunch of new people through, get new faces and new voices on the air, and we'll continue to do that as we move forward with the football season, but also basketball. And Jason has spearheaded the hockey play-by-play effort, and they've done two games now. Jason's always correcting me while I'm on the air.
Exactly. Keep us on our toes
here. It's good to have him in the booth. I make less mistakes that way. With that, media timeout is over, and we're ready to kick it away. Number 99, Dragon Keish, will kick it off for the Golden Gophers. And Minnesota, again, with that unique kicking formation. I don't know if I've seen any other team line up the way they do. They have Keish kicking from the hash, and we have essentially a bunched formation on the far side. We have a spread, you know, five guys spread out on this boundary, and then they kind of even it out as he comes up to kick. So something a little different, but so far has not caused any problems, so we have no reason to complain.
Exactly. It almost looks like there's half of an onside play, and then there's like half of a screen play, and it's just kind of a weird combination, but hey, if it works, it works.
Gophers kick it out of the back of the end zone, so Nebraska will start first and 10 from the 25. They're going to be on the left hash in front of the Gopher sideline. Martinez will be in shotgun. He claps, sends a man in motion. He'll fake the handoff, looks to throw, has time, over the middle, caught, first down and a little bit more, pulled out of bounds. It was number 11. Austin Allen, the tight end, with another catch. He was pulled out of bounds by 55. Mariano Sorimer, and the linebacker for the Golden Gophers. And it's a quick first down and a quick big play for Nebraska.
And you figure that they would open it up pretty quickly. Just like Jack talked about, they're going to want to make those explosive plays, get it tied up again.
Martinez will option to Johnson. Johnson's going to find a seam on the edge in front of the Nebraska sideline. He'll be across the 30 and pulled out of bounds at the 26-yard line. Another first down for the Nebraska Cornhuskers.
They're starting to find some room outside of the tackles, and they're getting some big chunk plays here, only two plays into the drive.
Just under 6 minutes to play. Gophers lead 7-0. Martinez shotgun. Johnson to his left. Sends the man in motion. Johnson up the middle. Johnson has a hole, but he's hit hard second level. And it's going to be second and 5 from the Gopher 24.
This is a really tough defense to run against, Minnesota is. So it'll be interesting to see what kind of mix-ups they're going to do with all the motions here on offense.
Martinez looks to the sideline. They'll send a receiver out to the left and two to the right. Tight end stacked left side. No back with Martinez. Sends a man in motion. They're going to hand it off. Johnson gets hit in the backfield. Johnson brought down for a tackle for loss. It was number 47 of the Golden Gophers, Jack Gibbons, who hits him and brings him down. He was initially hit by Golden Gopher D lineman MJ Anderson, and then Gibbons is able to come in and finish that one off. So now you have a third and long, third and seven to be exact, from the Gopher 25-yard line. Martinez in shotgun. Two receivers to the left and a tight end. He's going to have a pocket, looking to throw, and he's sacked on third and seven. Minnesota stands up and makes it happen. Number nine, Ademowu, the D lineman, makes it happen once again, and Minnesota brings the pressure, and it pays off. Fourth and 15 for Nebraska.
That's a big-time stand, and it really forces Scott Frost and the Nebraska coaching staff to think about what they're going to do. It's kind of long for field goal range. Looks like they're going to go for it.
And as we were mentioning during the media timeout, we have a timeout called on the field, and it's going to be called on, or Minnesota will call the timeout. Jason has corrected another error. Number five, Niles Pinckney, the D lineman with the sack, not number nine, Ademowu. And so, either way, if Pinckney didn't get there, somebody else was. A whole swarm of Gopher D linemen were on their way, along with a few linebackers. And so, we have ourselves another media timeout, and that'll give us another opportunity to hear from yet another Radio K Sports member, this time a returning voice. It is Elias Thomas. Elias, welcome back.
Thank you. Thank you. Glad to be here. So Bryce Williams, we saw on the first drive, had three rushes for 17 yards, which was definitely surprising. We were thinking Marquise Irving would be getting a big load of the touches today. But Bryce Williams is actually from Sarasota, Florida. He was coached by the current defensive assistant coach at Rutgers, Drew Lascari. He rushed for 1,500 yards as a senior in high school, and he was the number 18 running back in Florida. He actually rushed for 117 touches for 502 yards and four touchdowns his freshman year, but only had 39 rush yards in the last three seasons for him. So I'm not really sure what happened there, but he's getting touches today, so he's been running well. We'll see what he can do for the rest of the game.
Yeah, it'll be interesting to see what the Gophers decide to do with the run game now that you've suffered a few injuries and you have plenty of talent to fill the void. And so it's picking who's going to be the best fit so far this season. And with that, we have about a minute and a half, and we'll send it to a quick media timeout break here on Radio K Sports. Enjoy some music brought to you by our Radio K DJs, and we might be having some issues with our music, so if you hear music, great. If not, otherwise we'll be back in about 90 seconds or so. Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to Radio K Sports. I'm Trask Angel alongside Connor Mockney, Jason Ruttman, and a few others here today at Huntington Bank Stadium. It's fourth and long for Nebraska, and they have elected for the field goal. They'll be kicking it from the 40, so it's going to be a 50-yarder right on the dot. The snap and hold are good. The kick is up, and it's good.
Right into that Gopher picture there up on the screen too.
3:59 left in the first quarter. The Huskers with a few big plays, and we'll have to settle for three. A 50-yard field goal, though, to put them on the board. So it'll be 3-7 in favor of the Minnesota Golden Gophers. And we'll reset for a kickoff here from Nebraska. They went six plays, 43 yards, in just over 2.5 minutes. And, you know, that's one thing that was a concern, I think, for the Gophers, was the big plays that this Nebraska offense has been able to produce so far in this season.
Yeah, and they don't have, like, you know, the big-scale weapons that you might be thinking of, but this is still a really good team with a very experienced quarterback who knows this offense, and it's going to be tough to control him, especially when he's a dual threat who can beat you with his legs, with his arm, with his playmaking ability. So good job by the defense to hold down and not break on that drive.
Nebraska and Minnesota lined up ready to go. Nebraska kicking towards the open end of that stadium. And the approach and the kick is off. This is going to be retrieved at the goal line and returned by Minnesota up the near sideline. It's going to get out to the 26 and wrapped up by the Nebraska Cornhuskers. It was number 31, Chris Kolarich, the inside linebacker, on the tackle. So Minnesota will start first and 10 from their own 26-yard line on that right hash as the shadow of Huntington Bank Stadium is starting to creep up a little bit further on the field. Otherwise, not a cloud in the sky, a beautiful day.
Yeah, it's really nice today. A little cold, but nothing we can't handle.
No rain today, no clouds.
Too many
beautiful
of those days.
Beautiful day for football. Morgan shotgun fakes handoff, throws to the flats. Ottman Bell with the catch. Ottman Bell up the Nebraska sideline, and he's pushed out of bounds at about the 28-yard line. So it's going to be second and 4 for Minnesota with just over 3:30 remaining in the first quarter.
Yeah.
Minnesota in shotgun. They'll send a receiver out wide either side. Kokeith, the tight end, on the left side. Morgan now in pistol with a running back stack behind him. Nebraska, four down linemen, two backers bubbled on the edge. A safety over the top with corners playing pretty loose. They clap and they're going to hand off. Off tackle. He's got a first down and a little bit more. They'll stay on the Nebraska sideline, but it's a first down for Minnesota.
Looked like that was Kai Thomas, his first touch of the day. Nice little run there.
Kai Thomas, the third different running back we've seen so far today. We'll see how much this rotation continues as the game wears on. Two receivers near side. Nobody out wide on the left. Morgan shotgun. Thomas to the right of Morgan. He'll look to the sideline with 11 to snap. The snap, fakes the handoff. Has a man on the edge, and they're going to call it a catch at about the 42, right above the numbers on the Minnesota sideline. It was number 7, Chris Ottman Bell, who had to dive and catch, and immediately is swallowed up by a Nebraska Cornhusker defender.
Looks like the sideline wanted a flag for some pass interference, but.
And this is going to get reviewed before we have a chance to snap.
It was definitely close. Looked like a defender got there kind of early. But nonetheless, we do see that as no flag. And trying to look at the review here.
Yeah, so 2:28 left in the first quarter as both these teams will huddle up and await the official review. It's kind of an odd, it was kind of an odd catch. He had to come back for this ball and then he's immediately kind of covered by the Cornhusker defender. And he maybe was bumped a little bit early there.
Yeah, it definitely looked like it.
So if this stands, it's going to be first down and 10 for Minnesota from their own 43-yard line. And obviously we're seeing this from the big screen, but I haven't seen any angle that would suggest that this isn't a catch, Connor.
Yeah, I haven't seen anything. There was no, like, real clear video of that.
And referee is out on the field and has announced that the call will stand. So Minnesota will keep the first down. Ottman Bell will keep the catch, and Morgan will keep the completion. 2:28 left to go in the first. Clock has started, and Minnesota is ready to get this drive going. Two receivers either side. Morgan in shotgun. Four linemen for Nebraska, two safeties over the top. Gophers snap the ball, hand it to Irving. Irving is going to get hit in the backfield, but still find a way to gain a couple. He'll move the ball to the left hash, and it'll be second and 7 for Minnesota.
Nice little run there to get some positive yards. And just, you know, just trying to spread out this defense, going side to side, make them run, and, you know, not letting them do too many substitutions on defense.
Cole Keith will be lined up out wide near the numbers as a receiver, typically playing that tight end position. Two receivers on either side for Minnesota. Irving to the right of Morgan in shotgun. Four down linemen, safety over the top. Two middle backers, Morgan making adjustments, three to snap. He looks right, looks left, snaps, looking to pass, has a pocket, going downfield, and a flag comes out. The ball is incomplete. Ottman Bell attempted to make the catch at the 15 in front of the Nebraska sideline, and the defender basically ran straight through him, never turned the head, and didn't give Ottman Bell a chance to make a play on that ball. Good call there by the referee, and, you know, pass interference, I feel like, is so often, it could go this way, but that's one of the few times where it's pretty clear, you know, he's got to have a chance to make a play there, and unfortunately, for Williams, number 8, the cornerback, he is not able to keep his coverage there, and Minnesota's going to get a nice first down from it.
Yeah, not able to turn around at all, and he just kind of put his back right into, or his chest right into Ottman Bell and didn't allow him to make any plays, so that's a pretty obvious flag.
Receiver out wide for Minnesota. Number 14, Brady Boyd. He's going to be in front of the Gopher sideline. Morgan in shotgun. Motions a man across. They'll hand to Irving. Irving, check that, it's Williams. It has nowhere to go. He's going to try to cut back, and he'll be pulled down at about the 40-yard line, so a loss of a yard. With a minute remaining in the quarter, Gophers with more substitutions. Ottman Bell coming back on. 22, Brown Stevens coming back on. And Brady Boyd will stay out there, so it'll be Brown Stevens and Boyd on this Gopher sideline. Ottman Bell alone. Looks like one-on-one with the corner on the far side. A tight end for Minnesota. And a back in Thomas. Kai Thomas for the Gophers. Morgan in shotgun. He'll sling it across to Boyd. Boyd with the catch. Boyd with the first down on the right hash. It's first and 10 for Minnesota from the 28-yard line.
Nice to see Tanner Morgan have some really solid passes here. That was a solid dart right to Boyd. And that's not something that we've seen very often from him this year. So it's good now that he's got a time and blocking to make these plays. And then on top of that, making good throws.
And with that, we will have a quarter break. And we will have some insight brought to us by our Radio K Sports members. Gophers leading 7-3 at the end of the first quarter. We'll have a media timeout here. And we will hear from Jay Sander once again. Jay, what'd you see in that first quarter?
Gophers are looking great out there. We're seeing an emphasis on passing, it appears. They're throwing it a lot more than they have in previous weeks. We're getting a lot of pretty great receptions, especially from number 7, Chris Ottman Bell. He has had a great first quarter. With 2.5 minutes left, he made a fantastic catch that was so good the Cornhuskers felt the need to review it. He's had 5 receptions for 41 yards, and he's averaging 8.2 yards per catch, which is just terrific. With 1:20 left in the first, he got interfered with on a deep pass and gave the Gophers another clutch first down. So at the start of the second quarter, The Gophers are going to have great field position, and we are looking for some more passes and hopefully some more Gopher touchdowns.
Awesome. Thank you very much, Jay. And with that, we'll head to a short break here on Radio K Sports. We'll be back in about 2 minutes. Thanks for joining us. And stick around. We'll be back right after this. Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen. It's Radio K Sports live on YouTube. I'm Trask Angel alongside now Jason Ruttman. Welcome to the broadcast, except Jason's working behind the scenes making the broadcast pretty and sound good. So Jason's joining for the color commentary play-by-play in the second quarter as Minnesota is now first and 10 from the Nebraska 28. They're now on that right hash on the Nebraska sideline heading into the open end of the stadium. Morgan hands to Thomas. He'll fake it. Has room to throw. Looking downfield. Has a man open. It's a catch and it's a touchdown for Minnesota. Number 22 of the Golden Gophers. It's Mike Brown Stevens with the catch and touchdown. And the Gophers right out of the quarter break. Strike fast and it pays off.
And you know what made that entire play happen, Trask? It was Kai Thomas recognizing that a defensive lineman was unblocked, cuts across in front of Tanner Morgan, picks up the blitz, gives him a ton of time to make a beautiful throw downfield and into the end zone to give Minnesota a two-possession lead.
Trickett out there for the second time today, looking to make this an 11-point game. 14-53, just 7 seconds into the second quarter. The Gophers have scored to extend the lead. Trickett waits. Snap and hold are good. And so is the kick. The Golden Gophers lead 14-3 over the Nebraska Cornhuskers here at home in front of what is now, Jason, a relatively full Huntington Bank Stadium.
Absolutely. It filled in pretty nicely during the first. At kickoff, I'd say the stadium was probably about 40-45% full. Now it's up to probably close to 80. It's a good showing here, even in the colder October weather.
Perfect fall weather, perfect football weather, and it's also a perfect time of year to listen to the Sports Hour podcast. Curl up with the podcast on your way to work, in the house, wherever you listen to podcasts, or you can always turn that radio on to 100.7 FM or 770 AM and listen to it live on Tuesday nights. Or just go ahead and scan the QR code on your screen, and that'll take you to the Spotify playlist straight away. That's hosted by Connor Mockney, who was on in the first quarter, now doing the behind-the-scenes work. And Jason, you're on every week.
Just about, yeah.
May Longo, also part of the Radio K Sports team, a returning veteran with these two. And a bunch of the voices you hear on the broadcast are also on the podcast. And the kick is up and away for the Gophers, and it will roll out of the back of the end zone. So for the third time today, Nebraska is going to start on their own 25. And first series, they go 3-and-out. Second series, they have 60-some yards on 4 plays. And now what do we expect from them here, Jason?
I would expect that they're going to continue to try and diversify their offense. Obviously, Adrian Martinez, their quarterback, has been a star all year for them. He's their leading rusher. He's their leading passer. He has 10 touchdowns rushing by himself. I mean, that is tied for the Big Ten lead, I believe. And I think we're going to see more of him passing here, though. The Gophers have a great rush defense as flags fly.
Yeah, just as they were about to snap. Don't worry, I'm okay, everybody. We have a flag on the play, summary of what I was trying to say. So it's going to be first and 15 for the Nebraskers as it's a false start. So 14:53 remaining in the second. Nebraska trails by 11. Martinez shotgun. Johnson to his right. Two receivers to the right side. Martinez is going to run, looking to pitch it. He's going to pitch it, but he's wrapped up immediately. Well done there by number 14 of the Golden Gophers. It's Braylon Oliver, the linebacker.
That's exceptional defensive planning by Minnesota. That's the second time they've run that pitch option play, and Minnesota has been right on it both times. I'm guessing that's something that they saw in film and that they broke down. Obviously, defensive coordinator Joe Rossi, fantastic at what he does, great at preparing the defense for these games. And it's a reason that Minnesota has been so good, especially against the run.
Martinez shotgun. Johnson to his right. He's looking to pass. Slides out of the pocket. He's going to find Johnson in the flats, but overthrows him in front of his own sideline. Incomplete. Third and long for the Huskers.
Good play by Minnesota, getting some pressure onto the right side of Martinez, forcing him to find a man in the flat. And, you know, the pressure, the anxiety got to him a little bit, overthrows it out of bounds. And we got a third and long situation here.
14:07 to play in the second quarter. Gophers lead 14-3. Martinez, shotgun. Two safeties over the top for Minnesota. A tight end to the left of Martinez, looking to throw. Has a man in his sideline, and miscommunication there as the Nebraska Cornhusker receiver cut inside. Martinez throws outside, and that ball lands harmlessly on the Nebraska sideline and forces a fourth down and 15.
Sesi Ademewu was able to break through the line there, get a little bit of pressure on the quarterback and a hand in the face, and it definitely disrupted his flow.
Gophers shift on the snap. Punt is up and away. Not a great punt. This is going to land at the 39, but it's going to roll for about 15 yards. So the Gophers are going to start on their own 25. A nice bounce and roll on the punt. Turns it into a nice field position swap for the Nebraska Cornhuskers. And with that, we have a media timeout, our first of the second quarter. So 13:50 left. Gophers lead 14-3, and we welcome on Jack Bartlett. Jack, what do you got for us?
Hey, Trask. So I think that almost might have been Tanner Morgan's best throw of the year. Like, fitting it in there to Brown Stevens, that's Brown Stevens' first touchdown of the year, only his fifth catch in six games so far. And two defenders all over him, perfectly placed by Morgan. He couldn't have thrown a better pass.
Yeah, we've seen that a lot this year as Morgan is slinging the ball around a little bit, but he's also doing it quickly, right? He's snapping the ball, he's finding the guy who's open, and he's throwing the ball. And a lot of that we haven't seen a lot of that this year. We've seen a lot of him standing in the pocket and trying to double clutch, trying to find the pass down the field. And I think he's just trusting his gut a little bit more today.
Exactly, and especially on that Brown-Stevens play. Brown-Stevens is very fast, but it still took time for him to get across the field and get open there. So really good blocking by the O-lineman coming out of the timeout. And then here defensively, almost identical to what they did on the first drive. An early penalty set Nebraska back, and three straight incompletions, or two incompletions and one rushing yard. So a really good defensive stop, and I think so far the Minnesota defense has been impressive.
Yeah, I don't know if you could ask much more of the defense or offense here. Possession time for the Gophers in that first quarter was 11:41 of the 15 minutes, and the defense, you know, with only seven plays on the field in the first quarter, and then, you know, three and out here. So a really impressive performance so far from this Gopher team. The question is now, you know, do we start to plateau a little bit in the middle part of this game, or are we able to continue ramping it up and continue increasing this lead?
That's definitely the key for the Gophers, and I think especially in the Ohio State game, a lot of momentum heading into halftime, and after the half, offense shut down, defense couldn't stop anything. So I think especially for the Gophers, the goal is here, probably get back to the run game on this, chew some clock. I mean, there's 13:50 left, so there's plenty of time left for another Nebraska three and out or even a Nebraska score, and the Gophers will most likely get the ball back. And do you remember who won the toss?
The Golden Gophers won the toss, elected to defer, and so they will get the ball coming out to start the second half.
See, this is why you always defer. Any head coach who says that momentum's a big thing to get early, I'm not a personal believer in that. I think you always defer, make adjustments, come out of the half, or extend your lead. So I think here comes the Golden Gopher offense. Hopefully they put some points on the board.
Awesome. Thank you very much, Jack, for joining us during the media timeout. As he said, both teams out, ready to go. Morgan and the Gopher offense, first and 10 from their own 25 on the near hash. He'll hand to Irving. Irving off the edge. Irving up the sideline, and he gets tripped up. Got tripped into what, the 30, Jason? Ends up falling for a first down, but man, he had a lot of room to run on the edge.
He did. Someone just caught a hold of his right ankle, and he did kind of a somersault forward. It's enough for a Gopher first down, but he could have had more.
Golden Gopher offense really not showing any signs of slowing down in this game at all. A few third and shorts that they've managed to push through, but another first and 10 from their own 35. This time on the right hash, they have trips left in front of their own sideline. Gophers, hand to Irving again. Irving off tackle, nice cutback, makes a man miss, falls forward. It's going to be second down and 2, gain of 8.
Irving is such a dynamic runner. Like most of the Gopher running backs, has a low center of gravity, stands only at 5'10", is able to keep the legs churning even as people reach at him and grab at him. And he's able to pick up a lot of yards that way.
Gopher second down and 2 from their own 43. Coe Keefe will be the tight end attached on the left side. Two receivers left, one right. Morgan in shotgun with Irving to his left. 8 to snap. Morgan runs to the line to make adjustments. He resets, 4 to snap. He's going to hand to Irving. Irving has to cut back in the backfield, makes a man miss, spins ahead, and he's down at the 50-yard line. First down, Minnesota.
Bucky Irving, good recognition there. Realized that the hole that he was supposed to have wasn't there. Decides to cut back, like Trask said. Juked out a man. Is able to just pick up enough for another Gopher first down. They're situated right on the center of the M.
A pass-heavy offense in the first quarter. Now three straight runs for the Gophers, as they'll line up with a receiver out wide on either side. Two tight ends in Keefe and Spanford in the game. Morgan shotgun with Irving to his right. Check that, Kai Thomas into the game. Morgan makes an adjustment. Morgan hands to Thomas. Thomas breaks free up the seam, and he'll be down at the 36-yard line. It's a Golden Gopher first down. And I hesitated there because it looked like maybe Thomas got up a little funny, but then he popped up and jogged off the sideline. So I think I think we're good. I'm having some flashbacks here with all the running back injuries we've had this year.
It is concerning, but I think part of it could be the cold. Obviously, anytime you get hit in the colder weather, it's going to take little extra time to get up. It stings. It does not feel good.
Morgan in shotgun will make some adjustments. Two receivers to the right. They're on the left hash heading towards the open end of Huntington Bank Stadium. Morgan looks to pass. He'll keep it himself. And he gets hit at the line but will fall forward for a gain of three. So it's going to be second and seven for Minnesota.
Minnesota, it looks like their quarterbacks have definitely revamped themselves this game. Obviously, past few games, Minnesota's offense, especially the passing game, has been a little bit questionable. Tanner Morgan only put up 59 yards against Bowling Green. Minnesota only puts 20 on the board against Purdue, but they have crossed the 100-yard mark for passing now, and they look much better.
Reverse, flea flicker. Oh, it blows up in Minnesota's face.
Oh, that's a great defensive play. Great recognition by Cam Taylor-Britt, number five, streaking in off the edge, and he blows up that trick play for Minnesota. A little double reverse flea flicker.
Yeah, they hand to Bryce Williams, who flips it to the wideout, who then tosses it back to Morgan. And it's just blown up by the D-line of Nebraska.
It's a big loss for Minnesota. Now facing 3rd and 19, 10-11 left in the first half.
I'd argue that this is maybe four down territory for the Gophers. Get a chunk here, and then on fourth down, you can try to get the rest. The defense has looked outstanding. Three receivers right, two on the left. Morgan. Shotgun, has a pocket, throws, caught by Ottman Bell. Ottman Bell will fight his way up the right hash to the 32-yard line. Not enough for a first, but enough to make this a manageable fourth and six or potentially a long field goal. See what the Gophers decide to do here, and it looks like the field goal unit is out. So unfortunately, the reverse flea flicker is going to force them to go for three. But Gophers still in decent position here. It's going to be a 50-yarder from the 40 on the right hash. The snap and hold are good. The kick is no good.
Good attempt there by Matthew Trickett, but 50 yards, especially in college, is no gimme. And that one just sailed a little bit wide left.
So we have 9:08 left in the second quarter, and a Minnesota field goal that is no good will put Nebraska first and 10 from their own 32-yard line. And with that, we'll take a break, take a media timeout, and we'll hear once again from Elias Thomas. Elias, what do you have for us?
Yeah, so Scott Frost, head coach on the sideline in Nebraska, he won 2017 National Coach of the Year when UCF went undefeated. But he's been a disappointing 15-24 in four seasons at Nebraska. And this is a school that's historically been great. They're number four in the last 50 seasons in wins, so they're always a good team. Nebraska fans definitely are a little bit frustrated with Scott Frost, but something to point out is that 15 of his losses have been by one score or less. So we're seeing Nebraska just not able to finish games, not able to quite breakthrough and get over those humps and those deficits. So Scott Frost definitely has received a lot of criticism over the years, in the last 4 years, but he's again 3-4 this season, lost some close games as we talked about in the pregame show. So he's got to maybe turn some things around, or his job might be on the line.
Yeah, for sure. You know, and it's been frustrating for Scott Frost in Nebraska. You know, with so many close games over the last couple of years, but even more specifically this year, you have two top 10 teams on the ropes, ready to win, and you just can't quite deliver that final blow, and they've lost just by narrow margins all season. You know, they're a team that very easily, instead of being 3-4, could, you know, 5-6 win team. And so, you know, frustrating for Scott Frost in Nebraska, but also, you know, you got to start getting wins at some point, otherwise he might be out.
I would agree with that. And part of the issue is that Nebraska tends to fumble at inopportune times. Adrian Martinez, you know, it has been a historical issue for him. In his 34 career starts, he has 18 fumbles. And Nebraska has not won many of those. The worst off was last week against Michigan. They had him on the ropes, and all of a sudden a late fumble by Martinez allows Michigan to take a three-point win, 32-29. That's heartbreaking for their program.
And with that, our media timeout is coming to a close, and our teams are back out on the field. Remind you to like and subscribe if you are enjoying what you're hearing. If you subscribe, the advantage there is you get notified every time Radio K Sports goes live. You know, not just football, but basketball. Jason has been doing hockey commentary for the men's team. And then we also have volleyball going on, and we'll have baseball and softball in the spring. And so a full list of sports and broadcasts to get through this year. And you don't want to miss any of it, so make sure you hit that subscribe button. And while you're there, you can also check out some Radio K content, not just Radio K Sports. And with that, it's first and 10 in shotgun. Martinez is going to hand to Johnson, and he's going to be hit at the line of scrimmage and brought down by a swarm of Golden Gophers. Among them is number 9, Ademowu, and number 55, Mariano Sorimarin. Sorimarin's so important to this defense, one of the veteran guys returning. As Minnesota's going to force second and 10, Martinez shotgun, two receivers in the backfield. They're going to fake the handoff. Here comes the reverse, and it's wide open in front of the Nebraska sideline. He's got a seam to run. He's got a block. He gets tripped up at the 40-yard line. And after a failed gopher trick play, this one works out really well for the Nebraska offense and will give them a huge first down.
As Xavier Betts there on the reverse sweep, and that's really good play design by Nebraska. Minnesota is now used to seeing Martinez take off with the ball, especially to the right, so fakes like he's going to do that, but instead of running with it, flips it backwards casually to the wide receiver, and he's able to pick up a nice chunk of yards.
Martinez in shotgun, fakes the handoff, throws downfield, double covered, and it'll be incomplete, attempted for Toure, the wide receiver, number 3. And Minnesota, with good coverage there, surprised Martinez tried to fit that one in.
Yeah, Jordan Howden was riding the receiver all the way downfield. That was a risky throw by Martinez, and he's fortunate that that dropped incomplete. That very easily could have been intercepted.
Second and 10 from the Gopher 40. Nebraska on the left hash on their sideline. Three receivers near side. They're going to hand to Johnson, and Johnson will have a gain of about 10 or 11. It's going to be a first down for Nebraska.
For the second time today, Nebraska now deep in Minnesota territory, just a few yards away from the red zone. This is where the Minnesota defense needs to step up. This is where you're looking for guys like Niles Pinckney, and Mariano Sorimarin to put a little bit of pressure on the quarterback or do some sort of disguise scheme play, you know, flip the script.
Trips far side, looking to throw. Has a man on the edge, has a man open, but threw him out of bounds. And it looks like it was number 3, Toure again, on the edge. And in coverage for the Gophers is number 23, Jordan Howden.
That was very simply just an inaccurate throw by Martinez. He had his man, he had a step, but he threw it out of bounds onto the white line. Not much anyone could do there to bring that ball back.
Nebraska shotgun. One receiver far side, two on the near side by the Gopher bench. Fakes the handoff. Martinez looks to scramble. Martinez tries to find the edge. He won't get there. Wrapped up by the Gophers. Sorimarin, Coney Durr, among others, to stop Nebraska, third and long. And it'll be a big play here for Minnesota. Can they force the field goal? Or even better, can we get a turnover the first of the game?
That would be great. Nebraska's heading towards the Minnesota student section right now in the second, and that's probably going to affect them. The students have their arms in the air. They're making a ton of noise. Martinez is screaming at the line of scrimmage. It doesn't look like he can get his play out.
Tight end on either side, two receivers out wide. He rolls to his right, looking to throw, has a man over the middle. And it's a good catch in some traffic. Number 11, Austin Allen, the tight end, with another catch over the middle. And it's going to be a first down for Nebraska at the Minnesota 7-yard line.
I have no clue how Allen held on to that ball. He was cutting across the middle of the field, and he got absolutely popped. It looked like it was number 21 Justice Harris who came and delivered the blow. But, you know, good, strong hands by Allen. He keeps possession, and all of a sudden, they're situated at the 7-yard line looking to score.
Martinez shotgun. Looks to hand it off. He'll pull it and run it himself. And he's wrapped up in the backfield. Number 27, Tyler Newbin, the D-back, pulls him down for a loss of one.
Newbin was able to shed his defender and is able to get at the legs of Martinez. Big loss there. And all of a sudden, Minnesota has a little bit of their momentum back.
Second and goal for Nebraska. The Gophers looking to force a field goal. Two receivers out wide to the left, one near side. Johnson gets the handoff. Johnson has a seam. Johnson's in the end zone. Touchdown, Nebraska. And Minnesota Golden Gophers, after a really nice defensive series, give up a few big plays, including a reverse. And Nebraska is able to respond and score and put this game within five.
It's a good offensive play call by coordinator Mike Lubick for the Cornhuskers. It's a fake draw play. They end up handing it off to the running back. Everyone thinks Martinez is going to take it. He only has one man to beat and is able to find his way into the end zone.
And the extra point is missed by the Cornhuskers, so this will remain a five-point game. Minnesota will lead 14-9 with 5:47 left in the first half. And we'll head to a media timeout as this Golden Gopher team will get ready to come back out on offense and hopefully put more points on the board. But before we do that, we'll welcome on Jay Sander to the broadcast. Jay, what do you got for us?
Hi, thanks for having me back. I wanted to focus on Mark Crawford, number 96, a sophomore punter for the Gophers. Although we haven't seen him out there today, he was named the Big Ten Special Teams Player of the Week. The last Gopher punter to win this honor was Peter Mortel in 2013. He averaged an outstanding 51.3 yards on 6 total punts 2 weeks ago in the Gopher win against the Purdue Boilermakers. He had 2 career-long punts for 60 yards that game as well. The last Gopher punter to kick farther than 60 yards was a 61-yard punt back in 2017. During that game against Purdue, he also had 4 punts inside the 15-yard line, which you cannot ask for anything better than that. And he was supported by his special team unit, who didn't allow Purdue a single punt return yard the whole game. So we want to give a shout out to our Gopher special teams and our punting unit, and let's hope we see them keep up that excellent play.
Awesome, thank you very much, Jay, for the special teams update. And with that, we'll head it to some Radio K music selected by our Radio K DJs for about a minute, and then we'll be back for the rest of the second quarter here on Radio K Sports. Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to Radio K Sports. We got about 30 seconds left of our media timeout. Jason, what have you seen from the second quarter so far?
Well, as a half in total, the big difference maker that's led to Minnesota being up by 5 right now is the fact that they're completing their passes. So far, Morgan and Kramer have combined to be 11 for 12. That's a 92 completion percentage. And Nebraska, on the other hand, only 2 for 8. 25%, and that's just not what they're looking for. Martinez has potential to be such a, you know, dynamic, skilled quarterback in this game who can really tear apart this Minnesota secondary. But if he can't hit his targets, there's no way to do that. And Minnesota, as a result, is gaining momentum, and they look really good. In fact, Cole Kramer's touchdown pass was the first pass completion of his career on his third attempt.
This kick from Nebraska is going to roll out of the back of the end zone. And we'll have Minnesota starting on their own 25. So the Gophers lead 14-9 with 5:47 left in the first half. Playing in Minneapolis, Nebraska has suffered numerous single-score losses. The Gophers coming off a win at Purdue in a bye week. Minnesota looking to stay in the winning column. Nebraska looking to get back to 500. Morgan in shotgun. Thomas to his right, two receivers, and Kokeef attached on the right. Four down linemen for Nebraska. Morgan fakes the handoff, throws down the middle, has Upman Bell. It's a catch and a first down. Minnesota down to the Nebraska 38.
Now, Upman Bell absolutely flying off the line, had a full 2 yards of separation on Deontay Williams, and Tanner Morgan is very rarely going to miss that pass opportunity over the middle.
And he almost did as he threw a little bit behind Upman Bell, but he obviously athletic enough to be able to reach back and grab that. And it's still further, far enough away from the defender that it was a nice catch and run for Minnesota. And a big play when they really needed it coming off the Nebraska score. 7 to snap. Morgan will make some adjustments. Thomas will slide to his left in shotgun. Two receivers to the right. They're going to hand to Thomas. Thomas looking to cut up and is hit immediately and brought down at the line of scrimmage by number 31, Kolarovic, the inside linebacker for Nebraska. It'll be 2nd and 11 from the 40.
Interesting play design here for Minnesota. They have Bryce Williams back on the field, but they have two wide receivers out to the left of Morgan, one to the right, and they have a tight end at the end of the offensive line.
Morgan looks to the sideline for an adjustment, 10 to snap, two safeties over the top for the Huskers. Morgan fakes the handoff to Williams, looking downfield, has a pocket, goes sideline, and Upman Bell will walk out at the 37 of the Nebraska sideline.
Having Upman Bell back and healthy, he's been nursing, you know, I believe it's an ankle injury all year, and it's just been, it really changes this Minnesota offense. He is so skilled. He has filled in for Rashad Bateman nicely, and, you know, Minnesota becomes a much more potent, you know, passing offense when he's on the field.
3rd and 8 from the Nebraska 37. Three receivers left, two right. Morgan alone in shotgun. Three down linemen for the Huskers with two safeties and multiple backers. Morgan over the middle. Catch and run. First down, Minnesota down to the 20-yard line. It's a catch by number 22, Brown Stevens, who already has a touchdown today, and he keeps this drive going with a nice catch and run, 3:44 to play.
And I love this for Minnesota, taking a lot of time off the clock, making sure in between plays they're set. They're likely going to try and hold this for the last possession of the quarter unless they want to take a shot to the end zone here. Then they get the ball back after the half.
If you score fast enough and your defense is good enough, you might even have another drive this half to be playing around with. It'll be number 12, Cole Kramer, back in for the Gophers. Bryce Williams stands to his right. Cole Kramer runs off tackle. Cole Kramer up the hash, and he's hit hard, but a gain of about 9, and it'll be 2nd and short for the Gophers with 3 minutes remaining in the first half.
Kramer has kind of adopted a Lamar Jackson style of play where you almost have to expect him to run every single time, but he's also capable of throwing. It makes him very, very dangerous and extremely hard to defend.
Back into the game for the Gophers, Schluter, Kokeef, Morgan. Upman Bell alone on the left side, one-on-one with the corner. Two safeties over the top. Morgan makes some adjustments. Once again, we see Kokeef lined up as a wideout. He'll motion inside, though. Bryce Williams gets the handoff. Bryce Williams up the middle. Bryce Williams with the first down and goal for the Golden Gophers.
I love that matchup with Upman Bell one-on-one on the outside. The safety is way too far away, and Upman Bell is too skilled of a receiver to not at least provide the cornerback a little bit of help there. I think if the Gophers see that again next time, they need to audible out of the run and try and hit him for a touchdown.
2:20 and counting in the first half. Gophers with one timeout, Nebraska all three. First and goal from the 8-yard line. Gophers on the far hash. Trips, bunch to the left. One receiver alone in Brevin Spanford on the right. They'll hand off to Williams. Williams tries to get to the edge. He's hit in the backfield but is able to get up maybe a yard. And so it'll be second down and goal from the 7 for the Golden Gophers.
Looks like Nebraska has called their first timeout of the half with the Gophers up 5 and threatening to expand upon that lead.
So with that, you know, 1:58 remaining, Nebraska stops the clock, obviously looking to score before we go to halftime. Gophers looking to do the same as they lead 14-9 over the Huskers here at home. And we'll welcome back Jack Bartlett. Jack, what do you got for us?
Hey, Trask. So just a little Big Ten scoreboard update. There's not too much action going on today, but a lot of inside Big Ten matchups. Number 10, Michigan State is down 7-9 against Indiana. That is with 6:55 left in the second. Rutgers and Northwestern are tied at 7 with 5:30 left in the second. And coming up later today at 2:30, Purdue visits the number 2 ranked Iowa, who is the highest ranked they've been, I think, in maybe 10 years. Ohio State's been the only other Big Ten team that's been ranked inside the top 4 that would, if the playoffs started today, they would make it. And then later tonight at 7, a good game between Army and Wisconsin. Wisconsin's looking to avoid going 2-4 and try and get back their 500 record. They've had a couple tough games against ranked opponents similar to Nebraska, but I imagine Gopher fans will be watching that one closely.
I was going to say, I'll be watching that one closely and rooting heavily against Wisconsin.
Exactly.
It's nice to see them struggle a little bit for once. And any other scores for us, Jack?
No, that's all the Big Ten scores that I have. Other than that, in the top 25, a good matchup between Oklahoma State and Texas, but Texas is on top dominating 17-3. And then Auburn is up 14-3 against Arkansas, who just suffered a rough loss, 52-51 against Ole Miss. Great game last week. LSU is up 14-6 on number 20 ranked Florida. And A&M, who's ranked 21st after beating Alabama, which I think is a little too low after beating the number one team in the nation, they're up 21-7 against Missouri. And then College Game Day visited Georgia for their matchup against Kentucky, where Georgia is 21.5-point favorites, even though Kentucky is undefeated. So definitely an interesting game to keep an eye out for.
Awesome. Thank you very much, Jack, for the score update. And before we resume play here, I want to mention the Sports Hour podcast, next episode coming out just a few days from now on Tuesday evening. Check it out on RadioK.org, where you can stream it live or look at past episodes, or you can check it out Spotify, Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts. I don't know, where else do you listen to podcasts, Jason? Is that the main ones that I get them?
I tend to go online if I want to listen to it. Just type into your search engine, Radio K Sports, the Sports Hour podcast should be the first thing that pops up, and, you know, good stuff. Obviously, October, in my personal opinion, is the best month for a podcast about sports because all 4 professional sports overlap, or NHL, NBA kicking off their seasons, football in full swing, baseball playoffs, got to talk about that every week, and of course, the college football race starting to heat up. You're starting to see some of the surprise teams, some of the teams that have room for improvement, and this Minnesota team is looking pretty good right now.
Yeah, they are. And 1:58 remaining here in the first half, and we're back out on the field ready to go. Minnesota shotgun, Thomas to his right, Ottman Bell one-on-one with the corner near side. Morgan will snap. He'll look to Ottman Bell, floats it into the end zone. He's got the ball. Flags are out. It's a touchdown for Minnesota.
Oh, my goodness, what a catch. Chris Ottman Bell, how did he come down with that?
And even if he didn't come down with that ball, you got flags down for pass interference against the defense. So either way, this is a win for Minnesota, but what a catch by Chris Ottman Bell. As it stands now, they're up 20-9, and we'll wait to hear what the official call is from the referee. And it is pass interference against the defense. It's going to be number 6, Quentin Newsome, the cornerback, who just didn't have a chance against Chris Ottman Bell.
That was an amazing catch by Chris Ottman Bell. He was floating backwards, has his hands over the defender's helmet, and is able to still have the sense of mind to get one tiny foot inbound. 2 feet inbound. How did he manage to do it? That is unbelievable. That's going to be on ESPN tomorrow, without question.
A great play to finish a great drive for Minnesota. Still 1:53 left, though, in the half, so a lot of time. If this Gopher defense can stand up and get a stop, this explosive Minnesota offense today maybe has a chance to put more points on the board before we head into the locker rooms. And the kick is up, and the kick is good. Right down the middle, and the Gophers will lead 21-9 over the Cornhuskers here in Minneapolis. And Jason, you know, can you ask for anything else from this Gopher team so far in the first half?
I don't think so. They've looked great on offense, only throwing one incompletion so far. The run game, you know, a little different than in previous weeks, using kind of a tandem of running backs instead of just handing the ball off repeatedly to one running back, but I like it. I think it makes it harder for Nebraska to read what's coming, and they're moving the ball downfield great. Defensively, 9 points allowed in the first against a solid Nebraska team that put up nearly 30 on Michigan last week. I have no issues.
Yeah, you know, it's interesting. Irving, Thomas, and Williams all have 20-plus yards. Kramer's got 18, and then Morgan's got -9 on two attempts. But, you know, five different guys on your offense who are running the football, that makes it hard as a defense to try to game plan that and try to keep track, especially with all the substitutions, try to keep track of who's in the game and who's not.
Absolutely. And Tanner Morgan's up to 171 passing yards already. On the season, his average for the game is 146. So he's already surpassed that. He's on his way to potentially a 300-yard game.
1:53 left. It's fair caught in the end zone. So Nebraska, once again, will be starting from their own 25. Gopher defense has looked outstanding on about half the drives today, and the other half given up some big plays, which have led to points. We'll see which defense is out here for this final series of the first half. In shotgun is Martinez, looking to throw. Pocket collapsing. He'll have a good catch, and he'll get pulled out at about the 32-yard line, so it'll be second and about four for Nebraska.
Good job by Martinez there to not panic as the pocket started to, you know, shrink a little bit. Stands in there, stands tall. Instead of trying to tuck it and run for a shorter gain, he's able to complete a pass.
In shotgun with three receivers near side, Martinez looking to throw again. Has time, finds a man in the flats, and Johnson will run out of bounds for a first down near his own sideline at the 37.
I like that play by Nebraska. It's a delayed release. The running back appears to start blocking, then kind of comes out of the backfield as a third option for the quarterback as needed. In that case, he needed them, and it's enough for a first down.
1:43 remaining. Clock stopped until the snap. They're going to hand this one off to Johnson. Johnson hit at the line and brought down. Nebraska will have second down in about eight.
Looked like that was number 99, D'Angelo Carter, with the tackle there. First time we've called his name this afternoon.
Quick snap from Nebraska. They'll throw towards the Gopher sideline, and a great diving catch there by number 88 of this Nebraska Cornhusker team, Levi Falk.
It's a nice grab by Falk, but if Nebraska is trying to put another 6 points on the board, they're going to have to start moving with some efficiency downfield. They only got 75 seconds left.
Quick snap, Martinez looking downfield and overthrows number three, Toure. Toure's had some catches today, has also had a few opportunities that Martinez has missed some throws. And that was another one. He was open down the middle. So it's going to be second and long for Nebraska.
Justin Wally in coverage there. And there was a fair bit of separation between him and the receiver. He's fortunate that that pass was not a little bit more on target.
Trips far side. They'll throw to the flats. Off the block and gets the tackle. It's number 27. No, check that.
47.
Number 47. Jack Gibbons, the linebacker, gets outside in a hurry, gets off the block, and takes him down for no gain. Third and 10 for the Huskers with 1:04 left in the half.
Gibbons, the leading tackler for Minnesota coming into this game. He had 30 through 7 games. and the fans really getting into it as Kerncraft 400 by Zombie Nation blasts over the PA system here.
Third and 10, Nebraska is forced to use a timeout as that play got blown up and obviously still inbounds. So they have to stop the clock with just over a minute, and they still have quite a ways to go here. More importantly, they got to get a first down. And they're also in danger here of potentially giving this ball back to the Minnesota offense with just under a minute left. And with how this offense has moved today, Minnesota might be able to do some damage with that. First, though, we got to get a stop defensively. Martinez shotgun, one receiver on the far side, now two as they motion into doubles. A tight end and a running back with Martinez. Gophers bring four. Martinez looks to throw, gets one off, and nobody home. Incomplete, fourth down, and 11. Austin Allen was the target, but he's standing 10 yards short of that ball, looking at Martinez. Another miscommunication. We've seen a few of those today on wide receiver quarterback combos.
Did look like it. And another player to highlight there was number 34, Boye Mafe for Minnesota. He's tied for the lead in sacks in the Big Ten Conference. He was coming off the blind side towards Martinez there. Just couldn't get to him in time.
Low snap, but handled. Kick is away. And it's going to be played beautifully by the Golden Gophers, running up to the 26-yard line on the near hash, acting like he's going to catch. And that ball lands at the 12 on the far side and rolls into the end zone. Well done. Again, we talked about special teams earlier on a media timeout. And again, we see it from the Golden Gophers. Just a heads-up play, great awareness. And with that, the Gophers get to start at their own 20-yard line. As taking the referees a second to spot the ball here. I don't know what the delay was, but the Gophers are ready and waiting. 51 seconds, you have a timeout to use. You have 80 yards to go. Gophers lead 21-9.
They're going to kneel it out here, play it
safe. And the Gophers, man, oh, man.
Oh, hang on. Oh, I thought it was a fake. It looked like it.
Morgan will jog back about five and take a knee. And a little grumbling from the stands, but overall a very happy Huntington Bank Stadium going into the half. Man, with the way our offense was moving, I thought for sure we were going to go take a shot here.
I thought so too. I was going to say Chris Ottman-Bell already has 9 catches for 100 yards. Why not give him a 10th? But interesting play design by Minnesota there as they kneel it out to finish the half. On that first QB kneel, instead of immediately going down with it, Tanner Morgan drops back like he's going to throw someone.
Well, I think he was just trying to burn off some more time. But, yeah, he was standing for a long time back there before anyone on Nebraska got off the edge to come get him. With that, the half will end, and the Gophers will lead 21-9. And we will take a short break here on Radio K Sports, and then we will welcome on Jay, Jack, and Elias for the halftime show. So we'll take just a brief break here, about a minute or so. We're going to reset here in the studio, and then they'll be on to recap the first half and give you some predictions for the second half. So we'll be back on Radio K Sports right after this.
Sure.
And welcome back to the halftime show here at Huntington Bank Stadium. The sun is out, the fans are cheering, and Minnesota has a 21-9 lead over the Nebraska Cornhuskers. I'm Elias Thomas here with Jack and Jay. And Jay, what did you think about the time of possession? It was definitely dominated by Minnesota. You want to talk about that?
Yeah, for sure. The Gophers practically dominated that first half. The Gopher time of possession was 20 minutes, while the Cornhuskers had about 8 minutes. So the fans here at Huntington Bank have been able to see a great game, have gotten to see a lot of great plays, and they've gotten to see their Gophers with the ball for most of the time. So that's been fantastic. Another factor adding into the great play by the Gophers is that none of the Gopher drives in the first half ended in a punt. They either scored or had a scoring attempt. So this has been a fast-paced game, a lot of great offense from both teams, really, but the Gophers have just been really hitting all their marks. The Cornhuskers, though, will give them credit. When they are on offense, their pacing has been pretty darn quick, and they are making big plays when they need to. But the Gopher defense has been spectacular and has kept them to only 9 points this half. So great job by the Gophers. First half has been exciting, and we're looking for a great second half.
Yeah, that's for sure. The Nebraska has definitely broken off some big plays, which Jack actually talked about in the pregame show. But also, on the Minnesota's offensive side, the O-line is really showing out, which is helping everything with passing, running. You want to talk about that, Jack?
Yeah, sure. So the O-line, as we said in the pregame, that was going to be a point of concern for the Gophers since Morgan had been getting a lot of pressure on him early. And with those rushed throws, he was making some poor decisions, especially in the Bowling Green game. Our O-line did not get much momentum going, and Bowling Green was able to get some pressure on Morgan, especially on those last two interceptions. He did not have much time at all. Not saying it's solely the O-line's fault, but it was at least partially their fault. But today, they've been the complete exact opposite. They've been pushing the Nebraska front four very well, especially on that last touchdown throw to Ottman Bell, I believe, two plays before. It looked like our running back just ran through the offensive line, and he got 5 yards. So I think the O-line protection has been great. Morgan's been slinging the ball all over the place, which Elias will talk about later. And then, at least on the running back front, the handoffs have been well spread out between Irving, Thomas, and Williams, with Irving and Thomas carrying the ball for four times for 28 and 20 yards respectively, and Williams carrying it 6 times for 20 yards. And then Kramer has carried the ball 4 times for 18 yards and had a couple big first downs on third and second and short. So I think as the game continues here, let's look for the rushing attack to keep staying diverse with the 3 running back set and look to bring Kramer in on a couple of shorter runs. And then on the wide receiver front, Chris Ottman Bell is having an excellent game, would be a great fantasy pickup in any college football fantasy league. 9 catches for 100 yards and that unbelievable touchdown catch late here in the second quarter. And Brown Stevens, again, with his first receiving touchdown this year as a Gopher, catching 3 passes for 58 yards. And what I've noticed, at least with the receivers, is that they're getting time to develop their routes. On the Brown Stevens touchdown, he had a lot of time to come all the way across the field to the left side of the end zone. And even with the Ottman Bell touchdown, he had a decent amount of time, even though they were very close to the end zone. And I think the O-line and Tanner Morgan moving around and establishing the play-action game as well. Most of the times on play-action, with the exception of that one failed trick play, the Gophers have been doing very well in passing.
And yeah, the receivers are definitely having a good game, and that's a big part because Tanner Morgan is finally playing like 2019 Tanner Morgan. He's really looking good today. He's got 171 yards already, 14 of 15 passing with 2 touchdowns. He hasn't even gone over 170 in a full game, and in a long, few weeks. So this is he's playing really great, and he's definitely stepping up and being the leader that Minnesota needs. Also, touching on the running backs, like the O-line has obviously been great, but the running backs are finding their holes. I believe it was Kai Thomas had a run that he snuck through, and I don't even know how he found space, but he got a big 10-plus yard run. So everybody's just it seems like they're playing with a lot of passion right now. They really want to beat a Big Ten school. And now let's – speaking of Big Ten school in Nebraska, let's go over to Jay to talk about what Nebraska's doing, what their quarterback's looking like, and maybe what they need to do to look a little better.
Yeah, coming into this game, Adrian Martinez, the quarterback for the Cornhuskers, he was a bit of a concern because of how strong his rushing game is. Coming into this game, he led the entire Big Ten in rushing touchdowns with 10. And that, I mean, that's great. That's very impressive. But the Gopher defense has been able to keep him to negative rushing yards in the first half. And from our perspective, it seems like the Cornhuskers have almost given up on trying to get Martinez in motion. And so hopefully for the second half, we see Martinez still being held, you know, keeping him in the pocket, not letting him get any green on that field. We do not want him taking off, because if he starts getting his confidence back in the second half, and if he starts rushing that ball, the Gophers might be in a little bit of a tough spot, because he is extremely talented.
Yeah.
So,
oh, go ahead.
Oh, I was just about done. So, great play by the Gophers overall, and let's keep it up.
Yeah, and I would say that for Nebraska, as much as they're stopping Adrian Martinez, they are still getting those big plays that we talked about earlier. A lot of long rushes so far, and Martinez is getting it done with the arm occasionally. He's had some big throws. The Minnesota defense definitely needs to be more consistent in stopping those, but they've been pretty good so far. Jack, did you have anything else you wanted to add?
I just wanted to add that it seemed like every time that Nebraska was not going three and out, which was the opposite drives where they did not score, it seemed like their offense just sputtered. A flag and a negative play and a small rush maybe. But when their offense is cooking, their offense can get 10-yard, 15-yard chunks, and they march right down the field and score a touchdown and a touchdown and a field goal. So if Minnesota doesn't keep their head up on defense, they could easily give up those big plays like we saw in the Ohio State game. Like, they killed us in the second half, and especially it was because of those big plays. They didn't need 6 minutes to go down the field and score like Minnesota has needed most of their drives. They could get down the field in four or five plays and be in the end zone and already be kicking it off looking for the ball back. Mm-hmm. So I think coming out of the locker room, especially this year for Minnesota, has been tough. They have not generally been a good second-half team. They've been more strong in the first half, and I think part of that is the adjustments that the other team makes to Minnesota's strategy, and I just haven't seen as much adjustments from Minnesota. So at least what I would look for in the second half is more of Tanner Morgan. I think they should have, at that drive there at the end of the half, I don't understand why they wouldn't just give Morgan the ball. He's 14 of 15 for 171 yards and two touchdowns. You couldn't ask for a better game and a better comeback game for Tanner Morgan's confidence. It's honestly a great thing to see him doing that. And so I think look for him to keep throwing the ball, and then I think as he keeps throwing the ball, the run game will slowly open up and Nebraska will have to commit more safeties to defending that pass if Morgan and all the other receivers, Ottman Bell, Brown Stevens, if maybe Dylan Wright is able to get involved in the game some more. I know he had the only incompletion, which was a dropped pass because he got hit pretty hard. But I think definitely look for Morgan to keep throwing the ball to open up that rushing attack.
Yeah, I think it's important that everybody, you know, they keep the momentum here, keep the confidence going. And they're looking to get a big win in front of a big crowd here, as the sun is out. It's a beautiful day. Pride of Minnesota is on the field. Let's see what Minnesota can do in the second half and see if they can close this one out. You know, they have a lead, but they got to hold on to that. So it's going to be an exciting second half. And thank you for tuning in to the Halftime Show on Radio K Sports. And we'll take a quick break, and our Trask and Connor will be back shortly.
Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen. It's Trask Angel alongside Connor Mockney, Jason Ruttman, Jay Sander, Jack Bartlett, and Elias Thomas, ready to bring you the second half of this Gopher football Nebraska Cornhusker matchup. We have 1 minute till the second half begins. It's 21-9 in favor of Minnesota. Coming out to start the second half, Gophers will get the ball. Connor, what do you think of the first half, slash what are you hoping to see second half?
I really liked our pass offense in the first half. You know, about time. This is something that we've been talking about for weeks, pretty much the entire season, is we're looking for this pass offense to really get going. And in this first half, it really did. You know, their total pass yardage is 176 yards, and that's pretty darn good for a first half. And so we're going to look to keep that up in the second half is what we expect. And, you know, hopefully getting more run game going. And I look for them to come out and score on this first drive, really set the tone for the second half and not give Nebraska any sort of confidence or momentum on the defensive side of the ball.
And with that, both teams out, ready to go. The Golden Gophers receiving and facing the open end of the stadium. They're wearing the all maroon with the white socks and sleeves and the gold helmets with the oversized Goldie head, which might be my favorite helmet.
I like those. I like it when it's the Goldie head on the chrome.
Okay.
That's my favorite.
Yep. Nebraska will be kicking towards the Gopher student section. They are wearing red pants, red shoes, white tops with red lettering, and the all-white Nebraska helmet.
A very classic look for them.
Yeah, they don't deviate too far from that look.
No. No, they do not. Sometimes they have a black jersey, but that's about it.
Kick is away, and this one is going to be almost out of the end zone, but it will bounce in the end zone and roll out. So the Gophers will start on their own 25 right down the center. 15 minutes on the clock. We're ready to go in the third quarter. I want to thank everybody who's tuned in up until this point. Remind you to like and subscribe, and you get notified every time we have Gopher Sports going live on Radio K Sports. Jason Ruttman, who's on the broadcast today, is spearheading the hockey play-by-play this season. May Longo's done some volleyball. We'll have basketball shortly and more in the spring. Gophers in shotgun, first and 10. Receiver and Ottman Bell to the left, two on the right. They're going to start by handing to Irving. Irving has to dance. Irving is going to tiptoe his way to the 28. And it's going to be second down and 7 for Minnesota.
Some names we haven't really called too much in this game. You know, we've been looking to call Dylan Wright's name. He's the leading receiver coming into this game for the Gophers. So haven't called his name just yet. Only called Span Ford about once or twice, and that was very early on in this game. So look for them to be a little more integrated in this offense here.
Gophers have not had to punt yet today. Looking to keep that streak alive with three receivers to the left.
Knock on wood.
Irving to the left of Morgan. Second and 7. Fakes the handoff to Irving. Pass over the middle. Caught, first down, Span Ford. Minnesota with a quick strike across the middle. And this offense looks like they have not slowed down at all since the first half.
And what can we say? As soon as we say, hey, we want to see these guys involved, next play, look what happens. So pretty good start right here.
Gophers with 176 passing yards in the first half. And they'll add to it there with a long first down catch. They're on their own 47 on the left hash. Morgan in the pistol with Irving stacked about 3 yards behind. Two receivers on the right side with a tight end and Span Ford. They'll run. They'll fake, and they'll throw to Span Ford, who's hit at the line. And by the time Morgan got turned around there after the fake handoff, he had pressure in his face and not very far to go for anyone there.
And as well with Span Ford, as soon as he caught that ball, he was hit. So not much room given by the Nebraska defense there on that play.
Morgan making some adjustments at the line of scrimmage. He'll be in shotgun with Irving to his right. Two receivers on the left. Ottman Bell out wide right. Gophers heading towards the big scoreboard. Morgan fakes a handoff to Irving. He'll stay to guard. He's going to throw sideline. Caught, first down, Minnesota. It's number 16, Dylan Wright, with the catch and the first down.
There we go. See, we're getting more weapons being used here that we didn't see much of in the first half. So good job to see a little bit of an expanded repertoire here with some of these weapons.
So for those of you who don't think we know what we're talking about.
2 for 2, baby.
Connor's 2 for 2 on the day. Jason's usually right. I still don't know. I'm on the fence about myself. I'm just here blurting out words. But Gophers have a first down regardless on the Nebraska 37. Left hash. Morgan will look to his right. He's going to hand off to Thomas. Thomas will get behind a pile of O-linemen, and they'll trot their way to the 39. So it's going to be second down, and 6 for Minnesota. Twelve seventeen remaining in the quarter.
Don't worry, I wasn't going to say anything important there.
Just over 12 minutes now. 15 to snap as Morgan will take his time. He'll look sideline. He's shotgun with Thomas next to him. He's going to fake the handoff to Thomas. Time to throw. He goes downfield into double coverage. And the ball is intercepted. He briefly had a man open in number 22, Mike Brown Stevens, who has a touchdown catch today. But by the time the ball got there, the safety and corner were able to collapse on him, and it is picked off by number 5, Cam Taylor Britt.
That's the first turnover of the day for either side. So that first half was pretty clean in terms of turnovers, but that pass looked to be a little underthrown there. And like we said, into double coverage, and those tend to be picked off.
So we will head to our first media timeout of the second half and our first one of the third quarter. 11:53 remaining. Tanner Morgan has just thrown an interception, so the Huskers will get the ball first and 10 from their own 20. And we'll welcome on Elias Thomas to the broadcast. Elias, what do you got for us?
Yeah, it was just announced today that on November 13th, when the Louisville Cardinals play Syracuse, they're going to retire Lamar Jackson's number 8 jersey. He was told when he was shown a video at media day, he was surprised with it by Louisville, and he said he feels like he won the Heisman again. He's joining Johnny Unitas as the only retired jersey at Louisville. And it makes you think, who's the next Gopher that's going to get their number retired? Would it be his teammate, Rashad Bateman, possibly Mo Ibrahim, Tanner Morgan maybe, or somebody in the NFL, Antoine Winfield Jr.? A lot of big names, and it's interesting. We haven't had a number retired in a long time, but maybe we'll see one in the next few years.
Awesome. Thank you, Elias. Yeah, it's exciting to think. Potentially, in the last couple of years, we've had a lot more guys who are being selected in the draft, and we've had a lot more talent on this team that is worth talking about. And so maybe a few years down the road we are seeing some guys who are retired number L or worthy. So we have about a minute and a half left. Connor, what do we need to remind the listeners? I don't have anything for them right now.
Well, as of right now, we're in the process of making a new podcast for this week. So if you really want to have something to do on a Tuesday night or, whenever that's when we air, 6 to 7 on Tuesdays. But any other time, if you want to listen on an app like Spotify or Apple Podcasts, this is where you should go. We have a really fun time. We rotate through a lot of guests. We got some really big things planned coming up. So go ahead and check it out.
And Connor, you guys, with COVID, you guys are still having to record remotely.
Yes.
But I think that's given you guys some fun opportunities. You're able to get a lot of people on the podcast and a lot of different voices and opinions, and it's been fun to listen to.
Yeah, it's been nice to be able to rotate through a whole lot of people, and that way the process of getting new people acclimated to the podcast has gone by a lot quicker, because if we were still in studio, we'd only have about three, four, maybe five people. And that's, it's good to be able to do it over Zoom this way. That way, like you said, we get a big diversity of voices here.
With that, our media timeout will come to a close. And the Minnesota Golden Gopher defense back out on the field. They only allowed 72 yards of rushing in that first half and just 62 yards of passing, forcing 3 punts from Nebraska. Let's see what they can do here in the second half. Off the Tanner Morgan interception, first and 10 for Nebraska. Hit in the backfield is Johnson. Johnson will fall forward, and a swarm of Gophers will force him to only a gain of about a yard, maybe two. It's going to be second and 8 for Nebraska.
Good job there, swarming to the ball. Jack Gibbons held on to the ankles of the running back there, and he was able to hold on just long enough for his reinforcements to come in and finish that tackle.
Nebraska goes shotgun, no back. Two receivers either side. Minnesota, three down linemen, two safeties over the top. They'll motion a man in, fake the handoff. Time to throw, looking downfield. He unloads near sideline, and he overthrows number 88, Levi Falik, who we've seen a few times. I believe that's the second time today that he's been open, had a step. And multiple times today we've seen Martinez overthrow multiple receivers. And so the Gophers catching a break there, as that would have been, you know, a 40-yard pickup. But instead it's third and long, and this Gopher defense ready to get another big stop. Two receivers near side, one on the far side. Martinez claps, shouts, snaps, looking to throw, unloads, far sideline. Ball's tipped away by number 23. Of the Golden Gopher defense, Jordan Howden forces fourth down with 11:09 left in the third.
A nice job there by the defense to hold strong and force a punt, especially after a turnover, the first one of the day, just when you thought that maybe Nebraska might get a little bit of momentum there, the defense shuts them down. And that overthrow as well, just to hit back on it a few plays ago, that's inexcusable for a quarterback who's been starting for this long, and Adrian Martinez.
The fourth punt of the day is away for Nebraska, and kind of a weird catch by Anikstead, but he reins it in cleanly and falls to a knee. So the Gophers will start first and 10 from the 31, and with that, we'll have our second media timeout of the third quarter. Gophers lead 21-9 with 11:01 left on the clock, and we'll get ready to hand it over to Jay Sander. Jay, what do you have for us?
All right. This game has been eventful not only from a fan standpoint, but also from a historical standpoint, as we have some record updates. Starting with Chris Ottman Bell, he has moved to number 19 in all-time Gopher receptions and is currently one reception away from tying number 18. So big day for him. But that's not all. He's moved up to number 15 in all-time Gopher receiving yards. So shout out to Chris Ottman Bell. He is having a fantastic game, and hopefully he has a fantastic rest of the season. But the focus now is on Tanner Morgan, who is currently five completions away from being number 6 in all-time Gopher completions from quarterbacks. And with the way he has been playing today, barring that tough interception that we just saw, he'll probably get that today. So good luck to him in chasing that record. But the big news is Tanner Morgan just passed Corey Souter for number 4 all-time passing yards in Golden Gopher football history. So great job, Tanner Morgan, and have a great rest of the game and rest of the season.
Awesome. Thank you very much, Jay, for the update. And we'll keep an eye on those records as we continue further on today. I want to thank everybody who is tuning in and listening to this broadcast. We know there's a lot of different ways to watch and or listen to the game, so we're happy you chose us. And just a reminder to like and subscribe. You're able to get notified every time we go live, if you'd like, if you subscribe. Then you know every time we go live for football, hockey, basketball, volleyball, baseball, softball.
Soccer.
Did I forget any? We do
wrestling,
it all. We do
gymnastics.
It all. And so, you know, not only do you get notified for that, but then you also have the opportunity, you go through that YouTube page. It's not just Radio K Sports. We're operating underneath the student radio station, Radio K, K-U-O-M. And so they have an awesome collection of music, culture, art that they are doing over at the station. And you can listen to them anytime. You know, they're live all day, every day. Student DJs picking out music, creating podcasts. Same thing we're doing here, but they're doing it at an elevated level. We're
exactly.
Just talking about sports. They're talking about culture and art and music. And so it's a great mix, and it's a great relationship between Radio K Sports and Radio K, so we're happy to shout them out. And also the music you hear during commercial breaks.
That's what they play.
That's all from Radio K. That's from the Radio K DJs. That's kind of the music you'll hear if you tune in. So if you like what you hear on commercial breaks, then make sure to tune in to Radio K, KUOM. And with that, we're out of our media timeout, 11:01 to play. Morgan in shotgun, receiver on the left in number 22, Mike Brown Stevens. They're going to hand off to Irving. Irving gets hit, and he almost got out of it, but he is then wrapped up in the backfield by JoJo Doman, the outside linebacker, and brought down for a loss of about three. So it's going to be second and 13 for Minnesota from the left hash from their own 28.
It was a tough play there. The offensive line didn't quite get the penetration they were looking for, and it goes down as a loss of three.
Gophers will line up with the tight end and Co-Keeft on the left. Ottman Bell out wide. Two receivers on the far side. Irving to the left of Morgan in shotgun. Four down linemen for Nebraska. Corners out wide. Two safeties over the top. Morgan fakes to Irving. Time to throw. Fires downfield. Picked off at the 45. And immediately going down is a Cornhusker. But it is picked off and thrown right at the Nebraska D-back. So maybe a little miscommunication there, but the opposite response that you wanted to see from this Minnesota team. And you have almost the entire Nebraska team out on the field around their injured teammate. Still not sure what number we have on the field.
Number eight, and he looked like he was grabbing his knee. We see that on the replay here in the booth. He went down. As soon as he caught it, he went and grabbed for his knee as he came down with the ball.
And that's potentially a huge loss. That's a senior safety in Deontay Williams, such a key part of this defense. And it's a great catch by him. Good job of him getting his head around. But, man, oh, man, I guess, you watch the replay here, and Morgan did have a receiver over the middle, but just underthrew him. And so that injury looks like it, unfortunately, could be season-ending.
Yeah, that one looks tough.
And so we're going to definitely have to take a break here. We potentially, all right, he's up and he's walking, so we don't have to take him off the field with the cart or anything, but man, oh man, that replay did not look good. So hopefully he is all right. 10:11 left to go. We're entering into our third media timeout of the quarter, and it'll give us our third opportunity to talk with some more Radio K Sports team members, and this time it's Jack Bartlett. Jack, how's it going?
It's going well. Not so well for the Gophers this half. That first interception wasn't really Morgan's fault. I wouldn't really fault him too much. The double coverage was kind of slowly developing. If he would have thrown that pass a little harder, Brown Stevens might have been more wide open. But overall, a great play by the Nebraska cornerback to pick that off. And then on the second one, from the looks of it, it looked like it got deflected at the line of scrimmage, but nobody on the line of scrimmage even touched it. So I don't know if Morgan didn't see the cornerback over there, or it looked like it kind of was a duck coming out of his hand. Didn't have a good solid spiral on it. Ottman Bell was open if he got the ball over the cornerback on a shallow crossing route coming across the field. But like I said in the halftime show, the Gophers have not been a second half team, and it looks like that's continuing now. We were praising Morgan for his great play in the first half, and he really struggles here early in the second half, and Nebraska gets great field position. They're in Minnesota territory at about the 45-yard line. I just hope that the Gopher defense can keep doing what they've been doing the past couple drives. They forced back-to-back punts, kept Nebraska mostly in their own territory, and maybe I'd like to see a turnover here, a fumble or an interception. Nebraska's quarterback has been wildly inconsistent with his throws, many times overthrowing his receivers, sometimes even overthrowing them when they're wide open. So I think the Gopher defense is seeing that, and I bet they're ready to attack the quarterback right now. He hasn't been the rushing threat that he's been still. They haven't started giving him the ball. The Gophers have been really tight on rushing defense, minus the one big rushing play from the wide receiver end around. But other than that, this is another crucial drive for the Gopher defense to get a stop here.
Awesome. Thank you for the insight, Jack. And we will wait out the last 45 seconds or so of this media timeout. And once again, thank everybody for tuning in and listening. And if you want to get involved, right, if you're a student listening or if you are listening and have students here at the U, let them know. We're always welcoming new members and bringing new people in. And, you know, the reins are handed over to Connor, Jason, and May, and they've done a great job of kind of pushing this to the next level and expanding the podcast and the broadcast. And that's just going to continue to happen. So student-run radio station, student-run Radio K Sports, and, you know, all Gopher sports all the time. So we're excited to be here and excited that you're listening and ready to go now for the Gopher defense, who are back out on the field having to bail out this Minnesota offense for the second time in this quarter alone. Martinez and the Cornhuskers in shotgun. Two receivers out wide and a tight end to the right of Martinez. He's going to roll to his right, now looking to pass. He has a man wide open across the 30, 25, 20, and he'll be hit at the 16 and falls forward. Number 11, Austin Allen, the tight end who has multiple catches today. He's brought down by Jordan Howden. And it's going to be a quick first down and another big play for this Cornhusker offense.
It's tough to put your defense in this kind of situation, especially on short rest.
Martinez rolls to his left. He'll pitch out wide. Johnson wide open, 10-5. Pushed out at about the 1 yard line. So it's going to be first and goal for the Cornhuskers, and we've seen that play be lethal a few times today.
Yeah, they like to run that option with a little pitch there as Martinez got lit up by Gibbons again, but he was able to pitch it off in time.
Late substitution for the Gophers, and the Gophers are going to jump off sides here as number 70 of the Cornhuskers flinched, but it was after a Gopher D lineman, I think, came across the line. The referees are discussing right now, but it's first and goal. Flag is on the play. And they're going to call it against the Gophers. And so it'll be half the distance to the goal, so you're talking about, you know, less than a yard here.
Half yard gain.
And so it's officially marked as first and one. It's probably about a half or maybe three-fourths of a yard.
About the length of the football.
Martinez shotgun. Martinez hands to Johnson. Johnson's in for a touchdown. And the clock will stop at 9:29 in the third quarter. 21-15. Minnesota leads. And Connor, I don't think we can be surprised by this. I mean, Nebraska all season has had to fight from being down. They've had to be tough in late games, in close games. They're not going to just lay down and go away in this game. So Minnesota's got to stay sharp and got to take care of the ball if they want to continue to hold the lead in this game.
Like you said, they've, you know, come back against teams like Oklahoma and Michigan, and, you know, those are top 10 teams. And, you know, this is a really tough spot for them to be in. We all knew that this was going to happen if you jumped out to a lead if you're Minnesota. So just making sure that we hold on and nail down a win here.
And with that, the lead is back to 5 for Minnesota. 9:29 left in the third quarter as Minnesota's offense looked good. Looked like they were ready to cruise again in the second half. And now back-to-back interceptions by Tanner Morgan, one of which put the defense in kind of a tough spot. And two big plays, you know, then we have a touchdown for Nebraska. And so Minnesota, I think, you got to come out. I think we're going to see some more run here.
Mm-hmm.
I think, but I think it's important to get Morgan throwing the ball again on this series because we can't have him, you know, shut down here with 9 minutes left to go in the third.
I agree. I think they're going to lean more on the run game and then do some maybe slants or some screens, try to get the short, easy throws to get the confidence back up for Morgan, and then hopefully let your receivers get out in space to make some plays, make some moves, get some extra yards.
We have to reset the ball.
A little windy.
Little bit of breeze, those flags at half mast, blowing straight into the student section. Although the flags on the open end of the stadium on the top of the field goal posts are barely moving. This kick is out of the back of the end zone. And will be brought out to the 25 So the Gophers will start first and 10. Nebraska sending out their defense, which has not looked great today, but they also have done a pretty good job of slowing down the run. The Gophers have a variety of guys who have run the ball, but nobody who has really broken out or done anything too great. Irving leads with 28 total yards on 6 carries. Morgan in shotgun. Thomas to his right. He'll throw to the flats, caught by Ottman Bell. And a bad block on the edge forces Ottman Bell to be tackled and slow to get up. He's up now, but the missed block on the edge, Brown Stevens, that's the one thing with the screen. You're one-on-one with that corner. You have to get that block. If he does, then you get that edge, and you're probably able to get a first down there.
Exactly. Just poor execution on the block there, like you said. And there was kind of a little bit of a late hit there as well on Ottman Bell after he went down.
Second and 14, just under 9 minutes to play in the third quarter. Morgan in shotgun, two receivers out wide right, two bunched on the right. Morgan, hands to Irving. Irving hit in the backfield. Irving brought down at the line of scrimmage, no gain on the play. Third and 14 with 8:35 to play.
That was the 10th reception for Chris Ottman Bell on the day. He's now up to 96 yards. There's a little bit of a loss in the play, so he's down from his 100. But, you know, nice little stat there from Jason letting us know.
Third and 14. The Gophers backed up on their own 21. Last two possessions for the Gopher offense have resulted in interceptions. Trips on the right, two receivers on the left. This Nebraska defense spread out, a safety deep. Morgan with time to throw. He gets flushed from the pocket. Rolling right. Throws downfield. Caught at, I don't know, the 22-yard line and run out of bounds. So it's going to be fourth down, and they're going to mark him no gain on the play. So it's going to be fourth and 14. And the Gophers are going to have to punt. Catches by Dylan Wright. And here comes the punt team out for the first time today.
Yeah, I was going to say it's the first time I've seen the punt team. And then Mark Crawford, the reigning Big Ten Special Teams Player of the Week from a couple weeks ago, obviously, when they played Purdue with the bye week last week, is his first action today.
Kick is away and will be fielded at the 47 of Nebraska's half and brought across to about the 47 of the Gophers. And so Nebraska is going to have great field position here. And the Gopher defense, with not much of a break, is going to have to come back out and try and get a stop after giving up a touchdown on the last time out.
Yeah, not what you were looking for by the offense there. Going three and out is probably the worst you could do, especially with also losing yards on that drive. Now the defense has really got to step up here. They're put in yet another tough position. Let's see how they respond.
Martinez in shotgun. Johnson will stand to his right. Two receivers on the near side. Tight end motions across. They're going to fake the handoff. Rolls to his right. Has a man open. He fumbles with the ball a little bit, but pulls it in. It's a good catch by 88 Falick.
Yeah, a little bit of a stumble there, too. He was able to hold on, and I don't think he would have had much space after that anyway. There were a few Gophers around him ready to swarm.
Gain of 5 on the play. It'll be second. Check that gain of 4. Second and 6 from the 43. Martinez shotgun. Two receivers out wide to his left. They'll hand to Johnson. Johnson's hit in the backfield and brought down.
Big third down here.
Sorry Marin among a few D linemen to bring him down. And a good job by the Gopher defense of standing strong. One more play here to bail out the offense and get the ball back in the hands of Tanner Morgan.
Let's see if they bring some pressure here and make Martinez make a play quickly.
Two tight ends. They'll motion him across. Two receivers either side now. Martinez shotgun. Martinez looking.
All day
Martinez
to throw.
Throws across the middle. Good catch. And he's wrapped up and brought down at the 35-yard line. It's good for a first down. And they'll set up on the near hash. First and 10 from the Gopher 35.
There was some pressure coming around the blind side of Martinez with Maffei coming off the edge, but just wasn't able to get there in time.
Tackle made by Coney Durr, who's now guarding receiver all alone on the near side. They motion a man across to the Gopher sideline. They'll hand up the middle to Johnson. Johnson off tackle, huge seam. He runs wide across the 20, 15, 10. and is brought down at about the 8-yard line in front of the Nebraska sideline.
Tough run there. A little bit of a misdirection. Martinez started running to the near side, but then they handed it off, and the running back went back to the far side and had a pretty big seam and brought him within the red zone.
Nebraska will be first and goal from the Gopher 6. They have trips to the near side, single receiver with Coney Durr on the far side. Martinez claps, looks ahead, is going to take it himself, and he'll get hit and fall forward to about the 2-yard line. So it'll be a gain of 4 on the play, second and goal for Nebraska.
I don't imagine they'd really be passing in here. They love the run game, especially with Martinez. So I'd assume there'd be a couple more runs to go here.
5:17 left to play in the third quarter. Gophers lead 21-16. Martinez shotguns, moves Johnson to his left. Martinez hands to Johnson. Johnson's hit at the line and brought down. Second and goal. And he's brought down by number 47, Jack Gibbons, the linebacker for this Golden Gopher defense.
I'm calling his name all day.
And it looks like Johnson is potentially hurt or maybe has something wrong with his helmet as the referee stopped the clock to get him off the sideline. So 4:52, clock is stopped, 3rd and 2. And Nebraska, I don't know why the clock's still stopped. Nebraska getting a little bit of a free time out there.
Yeah.
Clock is still stopped. Now they chop it in. Into the game is Zero Yant at running back. Martinez clapping with Yant to his right. Martinez is going to run it himself. Martinez is in.
Oh, they're going to call him short?
They called him short. It's going to be 4th down.
About a 1/4 yard.
And I
here.
Think if this goes to reap, we're standing about right on the goal line.
It looked
and
like.
Man, I thought that ball came across.
I thought so too, but. I guess, are they going to challenge?
Martinez points to his sideline. And the Nebraska coaching staff comes over.
Scott Frost looks livid here.
12 to snap. 4 minutes left in the quarter. 6 to snap. Nebraska is nowhere close to being ready to run a play. And now it's whistled. And now we're going to go to a review.
They wasted a lot of time on that clock, too. I mean, the replay's up right here. Ooh, that is close. It looks like there might have been a slight lunge, depending on where the ball is, right at the point of contact,
before,
but then driven back.
Before Jordan Howden hits him, I believe he gets across. If I had to...
If I was a betting man.
If I was a betting man, I'd say he was in. Live, it looked like he was in. And so this will go to review. Even if he's not in, it's going to be 4th and inches. You have to assume they're going to run the same thing.
Exactly.
They're getting a decent enough push up front with Martinez and the O-line that I think they'll definitely go for it here.
And there really is no, like, true definitive view because there are so many players in this view that it's hard to see where the ball is.
Here comes the referee. And they are going to say the ruling on the field stands. So it's going to be 4th down for Nebraska. And I don't think this is a difficult call.
Nope, not at all.
For head coach Scott Frost. I think you go for sure. As this Gopher defense is amped up. They're backed up on their own goal line. The student section right behind them.
Literally 1/4 yard to go.
Gopher defense. On the line, pack in the box, in shotgun. They snap, they hand to Yurt. He's short! Minnesota stands strong, and they're going to stop Nebraska from scoring from the 1/4 yard line. 1st down for the Gophers, 3:44 left. They hold on to the lead.
We can see the replay coming on the screen here. It almost looked like for a second that the running back was going to be in. But then he got driven back and fell down, somersaulted, head over heels, ball did not cross.
And Yant is still in there. So Johnson, the starter, the running back who's been in all game, either injured or an equipment issue, as we still have not heard. But he was not in for those last few plays and potentially cost Nebraska a touchdown. Connor, I'm a little surprised they didn't use Martinez there.
I'm surprised they didn't go under center and just try to go up over the top of the offensive line.
Morgan in shotgun, standing about halfway into the end zone. He'll have Williams to his left. He's got six to snap. He'll hand to Williams, and Williams almost gets hit in the end zone. He's going to sneak out, though, to the one-yard line. And it'll be second down and 10 from the Gopher one.
Not a great play call there. Not a great play call there, but good job by Williams to be able to know where he is and be able to get out of the end zone.
Two receivers far side for Minnesota. One receiver alone with the corner near side. Gophers going down the middle of the field on their own one. 11 to snap. Morgan will make some adjustments. He's going to bring Kokeef to the left side. He's going to be on the line. Morgan looking to pass. Morgan lets it fly in the air and incomplete. The Gophers want a flag. Huntington Bank Stadium wants a flag. As that was a tough play there for number 22, Brown Stevens.
They even put the graphic up for flag on the play on the scoreboard, but nothing was thrown.
A lot of contact there, but no call on the play, so it's third down for the Gophers.
I don't know how you don't call that. I mean, he was draped all over him before the ball got there.
Two receivers near side, nobody on the right. Tight end and Kokeef on the left side. Williams to the left of Morgan. Check that. It's number 12, Cole Kramer in. Kramer will run it himself. Kramer gets hit at the line and falls forward for maybe a gain of three. So it's going to be fourth down and six, and the Gophers will have to punt.
Absolutely not what you were looking for. You gave your defense no rest, and you gained pretty much no yards on that drive either. So now you're putting them in an even worse position depending on how this punt goes.
2:30 and counting in the third quarter. Gophers still lead by five. Punt team is out there for Minnesota. The snap and the kick. The kick will land at about the 35, but it's going to roll another 20. Out of bounds at the Cornhusker 45 on the Nebraska sideline. It'll be first and 10 for Nebraska from their own 45. So 2:12 remaining in the third quarter as Minnesota sends out the defense once again. They've seen a lot of time on the field so far in this third quarter. Nebraska only with 8 minutes and 45 seconds of total offensive time in the first half. They have definitely surpass that just in this third quarter. Two receivers near side. Martinez shotgun. He's going to fake the handoff. Throws over the middle. Tight end's wide open. Tight end still running across the 20. Finally dragged down at the Gopher 15. First down for Nebraska. It was Austin Allen with the catch.
They've looked at him a lot today, and why wouldn't he? He's a big target, big strong guy. And just poor tackling there on the play by the Gopher defense.
Trips to the near side. They'll motion a man in cross and Toure. Martinez, pistol. Martinez hands the ball off. Up the middle, and he's stuffed at the line. No gain on the play for Yant. It'll be second down and 10.
Austin Allen's had over 100 yards already today. He's had most of their receiving yards. He's been their big target so far.
Few changes for Nebraska. The Minnesota defense will stay put. 1:20 and counting, second and 10 in the third quarter. Minnesota leads 21-16 over the Cornhuskers. Receiver out wide on either side, a tight end to the right of Martinez. He motions him in pistol. He's gonna run to the left. He'll try to pitch it, and he's swallowed up by the big man, 34, Boye Mafe.
Nice play. They ran that little option again, and this time it got stuffed before he was able to pitch the ball.
Just under a minute, third and 13. Nebraska has to make a decision here. Are you two down territory going for the touchdown, or are you trying to get a chunk so you can kick? down by 5, 40 seconds remaining in the quarter. Heading into the Gopher student section. Two receivers on the left, they'll motion one across. Tight end to the right of Martinez. Gophers, two safeties back. They're gonna hand this ball off. Off the tackle, he's gonna run forward. And it's gonna be 4th down and 4 on the Gopher 9.
This is a tough spot. I have a feeling they'll go for it.
They're gonna send out.
Well, I take that back. I have a feeling they're gonna kick a field goal.
Only 10 seconds left of the quarter, so I doubt they get this off in time. They are kicking with the wind right now, so they're gonna have to hustle. 3, 2, 1, and they're not gonna have time. And that might've been a little mismanaged by Nebraska there, as they would have liked to kick with the wind. Not a lot of wind, but enough that maybe causes you a little bit of problems on this kick. So we're gonna go to a quarter break, and we're gonna go to Elias Thomas here in a sec. 21-16, Gophers lead over Nebraska. When we come back, it's going to be a field goal attempt for the Cornhuskers. But until then, we'll hear from Elias Thomas. Elias, what do you got for us?
Yeah, thanks, Trask. Last week against Purdue was Coach PJ Fleck's 50th game as a head coach from Minnesota. He has the third best record in Minnesota coaching history after 50 games at 29-21. He's already tied for 6 in school wins, and a win today makes him the 6th coach with 30 wins. So I thought in the first half he had a good game plan coming out. The offensive has looked definitely slower this half, but hopefully they can keep things up, make it some more defensive stands like they've been doing in the third quarter, and help get Coach PJ Fleck his 30th win as a Minnesota head coach.
Awesome. Thank you very much, Elias, for the update. And with that, we'll head to a little bit of a break here on Radio K Sports. Just a short break. We'll be back shortly to recap the third quarter and get ready for the fourth. So enjoy some music from our Radio K DJs. We'll be back right after this. Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to Radio K Sports live from Huntington Bank Stadium. I want to thank you for joining us on YouTube for this presentation of Minnesota Cornhusker football. Jason, what do you got for us?
Well, I got a college football recap so far. Quite a few games going on today in the Big Ten. There are two other games aside from this one. Number 10 ranked Michigan State is in Bloomington, Indiana, and they have a 1-point lead, 10-9, with 5:25 left in the third. Northwestern home against Rutgers. They hold a touchdown lead. It's 14-7. In the top 25, Cincinnati Bearcats all over the UCF Knights, 35-7. A little bit less than half the third left to go. Texas potentially on their way to an upset over 12-ranked Oklahoma State. They're up 24-16 with just under 5 minutes left in the third. Arkansas at risk of losing again to unranked Auburn at home. They're down 28-17. LSU up by 2 scores on 20th-ranked Florida. It's 35-21 in Death Valley. Last but certainly not least, to the surprise of no one, Texas A&M, who have been playing very, very well lately, holds a 14-point lead over the Missouri Tigers in Columbia.
Awesome. Thank you for the update, Jason. As Jason is joining the broadcast for the rest of the game, as our color commentary. Starting off the fourth quarter, Nebraska will attempt a field goal to bring this game within 2. Here's the snap, the hold, and the kick. and it's no good. The Golden Gopher defense stands strong again as they'll force Nebraska to walk off the field with no points in hand, and back-to-back possessions for the Cornhuskers result in 0 points.
Well, kicking woes are not unheard of here in Minnesota. Last year, the Gophers really struggled with their special teams kicking. Obviously, the Minnesota Vikings have beyond well-documented kicking issues. But it looks like Nebraska got a little bit of a case of the, you know, kicking flu up here in the tundra.
Minnesota will now return on offense, starting from their 20-yard line. Morgan in shotgun. He has two receivers to his left, empty on the right. 14:57 to play in the game. Gophers lead by five. They're going to hand the ball off. Cut back, and he dives forward for a gain of about eight. It'll be second down and two. It was Bryce Williams on the carry.
It's interesting how Minnesota has decided to split up the carries so far this game. In previous games when they've had Trey Potts, Mo Ibrahim, they've given it to them between 25 and 35 times. In this game, the leading rusher is Bryce Williams with eight. Marquise Irving, seven. Thomas at five, and also Kramer at five. He's been running a lot from the quarterback position. So a different look for Minnesota today.
Morgan shotgun will hand to Williams, who dives up the middle again, and it's first down for Minnesota. They'll be first and 10 from their 33 on the near hash.
And this is a really good game plan for Minnesota. You still have a lead that's more than a field goal. You're up five. So taking more and more time off the clock, even though there's still over 14 minutes left in the third, is exactly what you should be doing.
Ottman Bell alone with the corner on the near side. Receiver in the slot and a tight end on the left. Williams to the left of Morgan in shotgun. Morgan snaps, fakes the handoff. Morgan with time to throw. Morgan scrambles. Morgan's hit hard. He got back to the line of scrimmage, but man, he got sandwiched between two big boys of that defensive front line.
Well, the Cornhuskers did not bite on the fake handoff to Bryce Williams. They end up kind of just sitting back in coverage, forcing Morgan to try and take off with the ball. And as he did that, the line broke down and he got hit right around the line of scrimmage.
Tackle was by Damian Daniels, 6'3", 325. And he hit Morgan with a full head of steam. Morgan in shotgun. He's got two receivers on his left, empty to the near side. Williams to the left of Morgan, 13 minutes and counting in the game. Morgan's fakes the handoff, throws to the flats. Ottman Bell makes a man miss. And he's going to get brought down at the 40. So it's going to be third and, what, four for Minnesota?
I believe so. Chris Ottman Bell now has 11 receptions for over 100 yards. He's the only Minnesota player who has more than 60 yards. Closest to him is Mike Brown-Stevens, who has 58 on three receptions.
Minnesota, third and three from their own 40. Desperately needing a first down to kickstart this offense. Who better to do it than Cole Kramer? He'll make adjustments at the line. Cole Kramer shotgun. Cole Kramer's going to take it himself. Cole Kramer hit at the line and brought down. No gain on the play, maybe even a loss. So now it's fourth and three. And Minnesota not sending anyone out. It looks like they are going to go for this.
Well, we spent so much of this game talking about how Minnesota's offense has kind of portrayed a different scheme here today. They have not been as consistent or as, easy to read as they were in previous weeks, where it was just a lot of halfback dives up the middle. But when Kramer's in the offense, the odds are high that he's going to run the ball. Nebraska was ready for it there.
Fourth and two. High snap. Gets it away, though, and still a good kick. This one's going to be fair caught at the 16-yard line. So nearly disaster there on the special teams. But Crawford's able to get it away and get a good punt away as Nebraska will be starting from their own 16-yard line. When we come back, it's 21-16. Gophers lead over the Cornhuskers. And we enter into our media timeout, and we welcome back Jay Sander to the broadcast. Jay, how's it going?
Oh, it's going great. Nebraska has seemingly been able to get big plays almost at will, and that has been the main focus of their drives down the field, just big plays. And there are two players that have mainly been the ones bringing those big plays in. The first guy, Ramir Johnson, he's a redshirt freshman. He has 10 attempts for 82 yards and both of the Cornhuskers touchdowns and a 29-yard run for his longest. With about 4 minutes left in the third, he went down on a tackle and he went to the sideline. So we hope he is okay. And if he does return, the Gopher defense needs to keep an eye on him and make sure he gets shut down. And the other player that Nebraska has relied on for their big plays is Austin Allen, the junior tight end who is at a whopping 6'9" and 255 pounds. He is one of the bigger tight ends you will see. He has 112 yards this game with only four receptions. He's averaging 28 yards per reception. So he needs to be stopped. We have to clamp down on these big plays and keep Nebraska from moving up the field like they have been this quarter. So that should be the focus of the Gophers if they want to come away with a win today.
Awesome. Thank you very much for the update, Jay. We want to thank everyone who's been a part of the broadcast and make this broadcast happen, including May, who's not here with us, but helps do a lot of behind-the-scenes stuff. But Connor, Jason, Elias, Jack, and Jay, all integral parts of this broadcast production. And part of the reason why it's so much fun to come to these games and do broadcasts. And we encourage others to reach out and join us if you are so inclined. 11:41 to play in the game, 21-16, Gophers lead. Jason, what are we hoping to see from the Gophers in these last 11 and a half minutes?
I think the Gophers are kind of hoping to go back to what they were doing in the first quarter when they were just so dominant over the Nebraska Cornhuskers. Getting more pressure on Martinez is going to be crucial here. And then when they get the ball back, taking a lot of time off the clock through runs that actually lead to positive yards and don't end up just kind of failing around the line of scrimmage.
With that, our media timeout will come to a close. And Nebraska is back on offense, nearly doubling their time of possession in the third quarter for the whole game. Now up over 16 minutes with only 8 minutes in the entire first half. Martinez shotgun, he has trips right, single receiver to the left. Gophers bring pressure, they run the reverse. Their reverse is no good. Oh, and Boy Moffitt can't run him down. But he's still gonna be hit and maybe brought down for a loss. Man, oh man, that was almost a 12-yard loss that would have brought him down at the 1 yard line. Nebraska running that same reverse they did earlier in the game. This time, it doesn't quite work out quite as well. Eventually is brought down by Thomas Rush for a no gain on the play, second and 10.
One-on-one coverage here, bottom of the field.
Martinez looking to throw. He'll throw to the flats, and it's incomplete. In and out of the hands of number 28, Steven Morrison, the running back. And it looks like Johnson might be done for the game as we still have not seen him back out on the field since he left earlier.
We also haven't seen Deontay Williams return after he went down with that non-contact knee injury on his interception in the third. That looked like a scary injury.
Two receivers out wide, bunched near the numbers. Two receivers on the right, a tight end, no back next to Martinez. Third and 10, 10:58 to play. The snap, looking to throw, pressure coming. Open down the seam, caught for a first down. Martinez hit as he throws. Catch is made by number 16. Check that, number 13, Doman.
It's unfortunate for Minnesota. It looked like someone missed an assignment there. If I was analyzing it properly, I think a safety was supposed to drop down, pick him up as the rest of the defense descended into zone coverage, and a little bit of miscommunication lets the Huskers pick up a first.
Misdirection in the backfield. They're going to run off tackle, and they'll pick up about five. So it's going to be second and five from the Husker 48. 10:20 and counting in the game.
That previous play was one of the longest for Nebraska this game, and it was the second reception by Betts, 27 yards.
Cornhuskers will stay in shotgun. Two receivers to the left. one right, a tight end unattached. That will now motion across. Martinez claps. Martinez rolls to his left, now looking to throw. He'll throw to the flats. It's tipped at the line and incomplete. The Golden Gophers force another third down.
It's MJ Anderson on the pass break up there, sticking one of those big paws up in the air, swatting the ball down. Fans as loud as they've been all day.
Couple of late substitutions for the Gophers. They're going to have to hustle. Martinez in shotgun. He's got two receivers to his left, two bunched on the right. He's going to motion a man across. 9:55 to play. They're down by five. He claps three times. Looking to pass. Doesn't have a man. Pressure coming. Gets it off. And it's a good catch for a first down.
Oh, that was right on the line to gain there. Fortunate that he was able to kind of lean forward as he was falling, pick it up.
Omar Manning brings it in for the catch. Tight coverage. Coney Durr just a little bit late getting there and not able to punch it out. So it'll be a first down for Nebraska, and again a third down conversion for a first down. Clock will start, 9:40 to go. Two receivers left, one right. 11, Austin Allen, the tight end, will become the third receiver on the left side. Running back slides to the right of Martinez. Martinez, shotgun. Martinez hands off. Run up the middle. And it's going to be a gain of about five again, so it's going to be second and five. And this Gopher defense, who is averaging only about 40 rushing yards against per game this season, has given up over double that so far today.
Just over 9 minutes left, and this drive is starting to develop some of the telltale signs of a scoring drive for Nebraska. They're now in Minnesota territory.
Nebraska, shotgun, two receivers either side, looking to throw. Martinez has a man's underneath. He's gonna have a catch and a first down. It's number 88, Falk, the wide receiver, who settled in underneath the linebackers and ran for the first.
Good hustle by Jordan Howden there, tackling him from behind. He could have picked up another 5 or 10 yards if Howden hadn't, you know, hustled up behind him, grabbed him.
First and 10 from the Gopher 35. On the right hash, near the Nebraska sideline. 8:30 and counting. Nebraska trails by five. Two receivers and a tight end on the left, one receiver right side. Martinez fakes the handoff, rolls right, looking to throw, fires down the sideline. No catch, out of bounds. And it was number 3, Toure, who reined in the ball but was out of bounds when it happened. So it'll be second and 10 for Nebraska.
Nebraska really has not used the rush much here, which I think kind of goes to show how important their running back, who is now out, still no update on his injury or if it was something else, but how important he was to their offense.
Nebraska, shotgun, motions a man across, now two backs. They're going to run off tackle. They're going to be hit and brought down. It'll be a gain of about five. It's going to be third down and five from the Golden Gopher 29.
A slow drive like this is really, really tough for the defense. They're tired. It's cold out here. It's demoralizing to get driven on down the field slowly where they're just kind of chipping away. They need to find a way to right the ship, get the ball back now.
7:48 and counting. Third and five from the Gopher 29. Martinez in shotgun. Receiver on either side. False start, Nebraska.
One of the guards pulled across the formation.
And it was 63 Nui, the left tackle, or left guard, excuse me.
Well, this game has not had a ton of penalty flags, and the ones that have occurred have not had a gigantic impact on the scoring, but that one might. That pushes them probably to the edge of field goal territory, potentially out. Third and 10 coming up, so it is crucial.
Everyone at Huntington Bank Stadium on their feet and cheering. Two receivers either side. Martinez looking to throw. Nice pocket. Bennett at the line!
MJ Anderson again.
Fourth down, and Minnesota is going to force another field goal.
Well, this is a long field goal. It'll be the longest attempted this game, and we've already seen two 50-yarders. This one is going to be 51 or 52 yards, depending on exactly where the ball is spotted.
And Nebraska may stay out.
And this is also the direction. Hang on a second. They are going to keep their offense out there on 4th and 10, down by 5 with 7:16 to go.
4th and 10 from the Gopher 39 on the left hash. Martinez by himself looking to throw, escapes the pocket. A lot of pressure, incomplete. The Gopher stands strong again.
Niles Pinckney in there on the rush. It looked like Boye Mafe might have gotten in there as well, and the Gophers force a turnover on downs when they need it most.
The Gophers force a turnover and get the offense back out on the field with the lead still intact.
Pardon me, that was number 20, Donald Willis, the redshirt sophomore in there, not Boye Mafe. He was able to get a hand in Martinez's face, forcing an incompletion and a turnover on downs.
So with that, we will head to a media timeout. The Gophers' five-point lead still intact, 21-16. As we are nearing the end of this game, 7:11 to go in the fourth quarter. We'll welcome on Jack Bartlett. Jack, how you doing?
I'm doing well, and the Gophers have had a notable history of having, especially this season, slow third quarters. They have not scored double digits in the third quarter yet this season. This is the second game where they've failed to score. The other one previously was against Miami of Ohio, and they've only scored a touchdown in all of the other third quarters. So it just shows that even with our high-scoring 30-point games, the third quarter is pretty consistently a slow quarter for the Gophers. So I'd say look for them in future games and see coming out of the locker room, even though they got the ball, they couldn't do anything with it. And I think a key, especially for the future in those big games with against Iowa, Wisconsin, and Indiana, we need to put up some points and some serious points coming out of the half, especially if we get the kick.
Awesome. Thank you very much, Jack, for your update and opinions. We will send it to a short music break from our radio. Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen. It's Radio K Sports live from Minneapolis. I'm Trask Angel alongside Jason Ruttman, Connor Mockney, Jay Sander, Jack Bartlett, and Elias Thomas. God, it's starting to get kind of a mouthful coming back from the break. We got all these guys in the studio. I got to remember all these names. Either way, Gophers are first and 10 from their own 39. Gopher defense just forced the Nebraska Cornhuskers have a turnover on downs. They go for it on 4th and 10 and are unsuccessful. So Minnesota with a 21-16 lead, 7 minutes left, have an opportunity here. They're going to hand the ball off to Williams, and Williams will dive forward. A lot of traffic, but he'll get a gain of 3, and it'll be 2nd down and 7 on the right hash.
Good play design by the Nebraska defense. They sent JoJo Doman, the outside linebacker, on a fake blitz. He ends up dropping back and forcing the running back to move to the outside where his teammates are able to swallow him up.
Minnesota quickly on the line. Still have 18 to snap. Morgan, pistol. Williams stacked behind. Two receivers to the left and a tight end on the right. Two safeties back for Nebraska. Morgan looks sideline. Morgan snaps, running to the right side. He cuts it back up the middle. Williams gets hit hard, but not after a gain of about four. So it's going to be third down and three for Gophers.
And I know that we've been saying that you should run the ball this whole time, keep the clock moving. But the Nebraska defense is going to be ready for a run, and they're too talented to not stop it on a third and three where if they know where the ball's going. Gophers might want to consider a short pass here. We haven't called Ottman Bell's name in a few minutes. Might be time for him to shine.
Boyd back on the field. Williams off. Five receivers out wide for the Gophers. Two to the right of Morgan, three to the left. They'll motion a man across. It's now Thomas who's standing next to Morgan. Thomas will stutter step behind the line and fight. He's going to be close to a first down, but he looks to be short.
That goes back to what I was saying. The Nebraska defense recognized as soon as Minnesota motioned Thomas back to the side of Morgan that the ball was going to go to him, and they just kind of sat on that play. So now Minnesota faces a fourth and short, but they're in Nebraska territory, and I don't think that you can punt. Right as I say that, of course, the Minnesota punt unit comes onto the team, much to the dismay of all the fans here, but especially the student section.
Gophers late substitutions on to punt, and Nebraska will have to hurry up and switch. Is this going to be fourth and one from the Gophers' own 43? And Minnesota is going to call a timeout here, which is really interesting.
I will say I'm surprised. This is a one-score game, and they're giving the ball back to Nebraska. If Nebraska scores, the Minnesota Gophers are down, and they are going to need all three timeouts. I think that's a bold call.
Well, and I think you have to hope that your defense is going to get a stop, right? Instead of planning for a touchdown from Nebraska and you have to go score, plan for the defense to get a stop, and then you're able to do what you want to do offensively. It's a tough call here. You're in the middle of the field, and if you get it here, great. Then you have 5 minutes to burn. If you don't get it here, you're giving your defense a pretty short field, and a Nebraska offense that's driven on you a decent amount. I don't know, Jason, if you're head coach, you're going for it, fourth and one here.
Fourth and one. Oh, it's a tough call.
It's a tough spot of the field.
Exactly.
You're just short of the 50. They're just out of field goal range. If Nebraska were to get the ball here, you're just out of the field goal range, but one first down and now they're
right.
But they still need a touchdown, and so it's tough. If they get the first down here, it's a great call by P.J. Fleck. If they punt here and things go wrong, it's a bad call by
right.
P.J. Fleck.
Now that I'm thinking about it with a little bit more time, I think I would punt, try and pin them down around their 20, make them drive 80 yards, and your defense was just able to get a big stop in the clutch. They have the momentum. They may as well try and ride that instead of risking the short field.
Yeah, it's interesting. You send the punt team out, but then you call the timeout. So maybe they have a change of heart. They have a chance to talk as coaches quickly and decide, you know what, we have a play up our sleeve. Let's run this ball for a first down. Or maybe they got a tricky pass play up. Who knows? So we'll see what Minnesota decides to come out with. Nebraska now, and you have to be planning for punt. You have to be planning for fake punt. You have to be planning for them just lining up and going for it. And so this is a big moment for both teams here. If Minnesota is able to get the first down, one, two, three first downs here, you can get yourself into field goal range and, extend this lead out to more than one score. So we'll see what they decide to do. 30 seconds left of the media timeout.
Yes. Here's my other thought on it. Mark Crawford is our punter. He's been so good all year. He's really, I've been super impressed. He was special teams player of the week 2 weeks ago, and it looks like they're lined up to punt, but they do have two gunners out wide, but they could turn into receivers if the Gophers decide to pull something from up their sleeve.
Yeah, I'm against the fake punt here. If you're going to go for it, you might as well line up and run a play, right?
I would agree with that.
But we'll see what the Gophers decide to do. Snap is a little low, but the punt is away.
Oh, it's a good punt.
This
really
is going to be
punt.
Fair caught at the 11-yard line. So the Gophers end up going with the safe call, punting this ball away, get a good punt away, and Nebraska's going to be backed up on their own 11. So, you know, I think ultimately that's probably the right decision to make there. Even if you get the first down there, you still have to rely on your offense to get down the field a little bit more. So hopefully defense is able to show up, get another stop, and then we don't have to worry about that anymore.
Right. Basically, what P.J. Fleck is doing there is he's saying, Nebraska, you need to drive 90 yards, score a touchdown, and then not leave us time to get back down the field and kick a field goal. Because even if they score and go for two and convert, Minnesota still ties this game with a field goal. I agree. It is the right call.
Martinez shotgun. Martinez with pressure. Martinez gets the ball away. Almost a safety.
Oh, I don't know.
Now we have a flag out for intentional grounding.
It's going to be intentional grounding or holding. Something there did not go right for Nebraska, and Minnesota is going to benefit from it.
Martinez was wrapped up in the end zone, and he's able to throw, and it's going to be a safety because he threw that ball away inside the tackles. No eligible receiver in the area. The Gophers come up huge with 4:45 left. They'll add two more points to the scoreboard, and they get the ball back. 23-16, Gophers lead.
Asese Odumeu just overpowering his man and recognizing the trouble. Martinez drops further and further back, finds himself in the end zone with, you know, Odumeu's hands all over him, and there's not a ton he can do there. It's an unfortunate break for Nebraska, a great play by Odumeu, and Minnesota now leads by a full score plus an extra point, and they get the ball back. Nebraska's going to have to punt off to them in what's one of the rarest calls in college football.
And the easiest call the referees have made all day.
I would agree with that.
He's clearly in the end zone, yet no one even remotely close to that ball. Easy call for the ref, easy flag. And everyone back on their feet here as they have just finished the Minnesota chant. And the Gophers now with another great opportunity. You know, 4:45 left. Go score again and put this game out of its misery, right? I mean, you've had a great game. You slowed down in the third quarter. Let's finish off strong. Keep the momentum going here.
Exactly. And Minnesota came into this game as the underdog. The Cornhuskers were 4.5-point favorites. And Minnesota showed a ton of resiliency in this one. I'm very impressed with how they've played, how they've bounced back. They're going to get another chance here on offense to put more points on the board.
And this one will be returned from about the 22 up to the 28. So the Gophers are going to start offensively, first and 10 from their own 28. They'll start on the left hash going towards the student section. 4:39 to play at Huntington Bank Stadium.
I think this drive is going to feature a lot of runs. Nebraska still has all three timeouts. They will certainly use them, probably more so as they approach the 3.5, 3-minute mark. See if they can force a turnover early. But after that, if Minnesota can pick up a first down past the timeouts, they're getting pretty close to being in the clear.
Morgan in shotgun, two receivers to his right. Morgan gonna hand the ball off, cutting in the backfield. And Thomas is gonna keep fighting, but he's getting pushed back further and further. He's going to end up losing 5.
It looks like they're going to give him a little bit of forward progress there. Only take away 3, it appears. But still not exactly what Minnesota was looking for in terms of their first offensive play of this drive.
And you're trying to run clock here a little bit, but I think there's a balance there, right? You have to get the first down. You might need to start airing this ball out to get yourself a little wiggle room as they're expecting run.
Goldie Gopher doing his celebratory 23 push-ups, representative of the 23 Minnesota points.
Kramer's gonna hand the ball off. Williams bounces off of a tackle. Williams will pick up a big gain, and it'll put the Gophers at 3rd and 5 with 3:40 left to play in the game.
So now this becomes an interesting play call. Do you leave Kramer in as an option quarterback? He can throw, he can run, he can hand it off. Do you bring Tanner Morgan back in, recognizing that he had a fantastic first half, has struggled a little bit more in the second, but he has the best connection with the receivers?
P.J. Fleck decides to go with the latter and put Morgan back on the field. Minnesota with two receivers to the left, empty on the right. Morgan, pistol. Williams stacked behind him. Five to snap. Morgan at the line. Two to snap. Morgan gets the ball away. 3 minutes to play. The run. And it, man, oh man, it's close. Bryce Williams dives forward. Bryce Williams gets the first down. Minnesota first and 10 from the 39.
This is good. Just crossed the 3 minute mark, so we are down to the last 180 seconds of this game. Nebraska still has all their timeouts. They're gonna start using them here.
Minnesota getting lined up. Clock has resumed. 20 to snap, and Minnesota should let this thing run all the way. Kramer back in for the Gophers. Two receivers to his right, nobody on the left. Kramer watching that play clock. He'll now look sideline with eight to snap. He looks back, looks again. Four to snap. Kramer gets the ball. He's going to hand it off. Williams just kind of resting on those D-backs and letting them propel him forward as he'll pick up a gain of four. It's going to be second and six.
Timeout charge to Nebraska. 2:21 left in this game. Minnesota, this is a huge opportunity for them. Nebraska is a very good football team. They were extremely competitive against three top 10 teams in the nation. And now the Gophers have a chance to upset them at home.
Yeah, it'll be interesting to see what they can do on this drive, a statement drive for them. Can they put the ball on the ground and do what they need to do? We'll head to a media timeout here. 23-16 Gophers lead with 2:21 left in the game. Jack is back on as our sideline reporter. Jack, what do you got for us?
Hello, guys. So just a little fun fact about that last safety. The last safety the Gophers had was in 2018 against Miami of Florida. So it's been 3 years now since the Gophers have last had a safety, and that's a huge 2 points right there. Puts the Gophers up by seven and makes sure that Nebraska needs a touchdown and the extra point or the 2 point. So that was a big turning point in this game. And then in terms of the Big Ten scoreboard, looking back, Michigan State is up 17-15 against Indiana, coming down to the wire in the fourth quarter. Northwestern is up on Rutgers 21-7, and Iowa and Purdue still have yet to start. That starts at 2:30. Elsewhere in the top 25, Cincinnati is taking care of business against UCF 42-14. Oklahoma State and Texas are knotted in a close one. Oklahoma State is down two with 7:17 left in the fourth quarter. Arkansas has been dropping in the rankings lately. They've played a lot of really strong teams, and they're losing again against Auburn. They're down eight with 3:49 left in the fourth. LSU and Florida has been a back-and-forth battle. LSU is now up seven, 42-35, with a lot of time left in the fourth. And then Texas A&M, the hot team in college football right now, up 35-14 against Missouri. Looks like they should be able to handle business. And the Gophers, another quick stat, the Gophers are still down in total yardage against Nebraska, 328-314, and we just on that last run surpassed 100 yards rushing. And coming into this game, we were expecting to see a more heavy rushing attack, but a more maybe encouraging the Gophers to go for more passing, and they have clearly listened to us this game. 214 yards passing for Morgan. He hasn't been as effective, obviously, in the second half with the two interceptions, but to see the Gophers having more passing yards than rushing yards is promising, especially for the future and as our offense is able to adapt. And I can totally see in the future with the two running backs out, as Morgan continues to develop that passing game that he found in 2019 with his career year, I think he could continue to do that.
Awesome. Thank you very much, Jack, for joining us during the media timeout. We have about 25 seconds left of the media timeout, 2:21 in the game. And we're poised for an exciting finish here.
Absolutely. And you know what's really helped Minnesota this game? The lack of penalties. They have two penalties for 11 yards all game. If you're PJ Fleck, there is fundamentally nothing more that you can ask for.
You could ask for one penalty or
Suppose zero penalties.
No, but you're right, though. I mean, two penalties on the game for, what did you say, 11 yards?
11 yards.
I mean, that's almost nothing compared to the game overall, and the offense is able to overcome those penalties, too, so nothing wrong with that at all. Kramer's going to be back in for Minnesota. It's second and six.
Kramer's going to hand to Williams. Williams
on,
breaks
Williams.
Free. He's down the Nebraska sideline. 20, 15, 10, 5. Touchdown, Minnesota.
Oh, complete defensive breakdown by the Nebraska Cornhuskers defense, expecting the run to go the other way. Williams finds a hole, takes it to the house, and the Gophers are about as close as they can be to putting this one away.
They now lead 29-16. With an extra point, they'll be up by an even 14, forcing Nebraska to score twice in the final 2:12. And unfortunately for the Cornhuskers, they might not get a win here in Minneapolis. Although, good news is, if this is the final score, they'll break their streak for single score losses.
That is true. That is true.
So that's a positive for them. Still a chance, though, as they have a couple timeouts, and they've been able to break big plays in this game. So it's not over yet for the Gophers and Cornhuskers, but that extra point is good. So the Gophers will lead 30-16 with 2:12 remaining in the game. They lead by 14, biggest lead of the game. That potentially was our biggest play of the game in terms of yardage, definitely our longest run of the game. And so Minnesota doing exactly what you have to do offensively in that situation. You have to keep the ball on the ground. You have to get a first down, first downs, and eventually you break it free and score to hopefully put a cap on this game and get the Gophers a win coming out of the bye week.
And I just want to go back to one of the plays earlier in the game. Nebraska has the ball at literally the 6-inch line. The tip of the ball is, you know, less than a ruler's length away from the goal line plane. Minnesota, fourth and goal, huge stop. It made ESPN. I got an ESPN update on my phone, and it prevents Nebraska from scoring. Granted, Minnesota had to punt off after that, but that's huge. If we can hold Nebraska to 16 points, that really shows just how stout this defense is.
Here's the kick from the Gophers. It's a line drive through the back of the end zone, and it will start Nebraska at their own 25. Nebraska has two timeouts remaining. And let's say even if they are able to break a couple plays loose here, get down and score, well, then you send your defense back out, which showed no real signs of being able to slow down the Minnesota run on that last series.
No, and Adrian Martinez has not looked exceptional for them this game. They're going to need him to get his arm into this drive and find the completions.
30-16, Gophers lead the Cornhuskers here in Minneapolis. 2:12 to play. Martinez looking to throw. He'll find a man in the flats. Flags fly. Tackle is made by the Gophers. Coney Durr wrapped him up for a gain of about 2. Clock will stop at 2:07. Two flags in the backfield. I think the Cornhuskers are backing it up.
Oh, no. It's a personal foul against Minnesota. That'll move the Cornhuskers up 15 yards.
So roughing the passer is called against Boy Mafe, who we haven't talked a lot about today. He had a couple big plays earlier in the fourth quarter, but otherwise relatively quiet for being the sack leader right now. And that'll move Nebraska up first and 10 to the 42. They're on the right hash. Clock is running. It's at 2 minutes. Martinez looking to throw. Hit as he throws. And that one's caught, and a big hit there by number 23, Jordan Howden, as that receiver bent all kind of weird ways.
Yeah, that's a scary hit. Anytime a receiver is turned the opposite way from a defender and they go straight into their back, it always makes you a little nervous because you get concerned about the spine and the spinal cord. Fortunately, everyone was completely fine after that play, it looked like, but dangerous hit.
Another nice chunk pass from Nebraska will be a first down, and I think the Gopher defense needs to tighten up a little bit here. D-backs are playing pretty relaxed on these receivers as the Cornhuskers are now first and 10 from the Gopher 20 with a minute 45 left. No timeouts being used yet.
Stadium has gotten quiet. A lot of fans have left since the Gophers scored that touchdown to put them up by 14.
This catch will be short of the first down. over the middle. They'll be on the right hash. Clock is running. It'll be second down and two.
Play made there by number zero, Justin Wally.
Martinez, shotgun. He'll hand it off. They'll run it. And it's going to be a first down for Nebraska. The referee's blowing it dead as we might have an injured player.
Let's take a look. It's an injured player timeout. As Trask said, a minute 23 left in this game. Gophers up by 14. They're getting very close to going up 4-2 on the season. And really, I mean, they put up a great fight against Ohio State in week one, a game that everyone expected to be a blowout. And then obviously there was the homecoming weekend upset against Bowling Green. But Minnesota has shown a lot of strength recently.
Martinez shotgun floats one to the end zone, and it's caught. So a quick score by the Cornhuskers, caught by number 11, Austin Allen, who's had just a plethora of catches today. And really a poor performance from this Gopher defense.
That's a nice catch from Allen, though.
You let them go drive down the field, bunch of big plays. Now you got to hope that your offense can come out and have at least two or three decent runs to put this game away.
I'll give credit where credit's due. Allen went up and was falling backwards with Jordan Howden and, you know, blanketed all over him and still was able to come down with that ball. It's a nice catch.
The kick is up, and the kick is good. So Nebraska puts themselves back within a score. This is familiar territory for them. Within one score, they've had a lot of losses over the past couple of years, and they're hoping that they can close this game out with maybe a win in Minneapolis. Minnesota, though, leading 30-23. A minute 12 remaining. Nebraska with two timeouts, so Minnesota will have to get probably one first down. If they can get one first down, they're going to be right where they need to be. And the referee's whistling for both teams to come out. I'd have to imagine Nebraska's going to attempt an onside kick here.
So Minnesota is sending out their hands team, it looks like, and Nebraska's lining up an onside kick formation. So for an onside kick, the ball's going to have to travel 10 yards. All the Minnesota Gophers are lined up exactly on that 10-yard line. They have the distinct advantage in this situation, but the football being oblong, you never know how it's going to bounce.
So Nebraska getting it set up here. They're balanced on either side of the kicker, so we'll see which side they end up going to. They're going to go to the left. This one is not going to travel 10 yards. Oh, man.
A Minnesota player touched it. It looked like it was
the Gophers.
Number
the 14, Gophers recovering.
Brady Boyd.
The ball bounced around a little bit, though, after that initial touch. But it is recovered by the Gophers at the 44-yard line. So the Gophers will be first and 10 from the right hash with a minute 12 remaining, heading towards their student section.
Good play there by Brady Boyd, recognizing that instead of trying to pick it up and run with it, he should just fall on it, make sure to protect it. Nothing more came of the onside kick, although it was a pretty nice one.
Clock's been adjusted, 1:11 remaining. It'll start on the snap. Kramer is in for Morgan. Kramer shotgun, looks sideline. He'll snap and hand the ball off. And a lot of traffic, but pick up a gain of two, maybe three on the play. So it's going to be second and 7 for the Gophers. Clock has stopped at 1:07 as Nebraska has used their second timeout. So Nebraska will have one timeout remaining. 1:07 left, second and 7. So they're going to be able to stop this clock again before a minute. And then the Gophers will be able to drain most of the clock away. If they have to punt, we'll be able to drain most of the clock away before they give the ball back to Nebraska. But if they can get a first down, then obviously that's the end of the game.
That's correct. Morgan is going to head off to the sideline. P. P.J. Fleck opting for the multi-threat option in Cole Kramer. I like the call.
Yeah, especially when, you know, everyone here knows that you're going to be running the ball, so why not put two guys out there that have the ability to run the ball, and why risk hurting Morgan on a potential run by a QB? Here's a run, and here is a first down for the Minnesota Gophers.
That should just about do it. Nebraska, with only one timeout left, looks like they're going to suffer a defeat here in Minnesota.
And they're going to suffer a one-score defeat again. You know, I think Nebraska, we were talking about this off-air, I think they're a better team than their, you know, their record reflects. But if you can't make that final punch at the end of the game, then you're never going to be elevated to one of those top teams in the Big Ten. Morgan will come in. Morgan will take a knee. And the Golden Gophers will not have to run another play as we'll watch the last 30 seconds click down off the clock as Minnesota is going to come away with a victory 30-29 over the Nebraska Cornhuskers. And P.J. Fleck runs out and jumps up and bear hugs one of the police officer security guards that follows him around on the field. And a good win, I'd argue a great win for Minnesota coming out of the bye week, coming out of, you know, some people who are asking a lot of questions about this team and why they lost. And I think they did a really good job of showing, hey, we can throw the ball on offense. Hey, we can stop guys on defense. The only downside to this game, I think, Jason, were the two interceptions.
I would agree. But I think in terms of Nebraska, a lot of the questions that Minnesota had last week, they're now going to have to ask themselves as they prepare for their next game. A lot of the blame is going to fall on head coach Scott Frost. Not that it's entirely deserved, but if your team can't seem to close out tight games, I mean, there's not a ton that you can do as a head coach to defend yourself. With him at the helm, the Cornhuskers are 15-25 following this loss, and he was wildly successful at UCF in Florida. So I think that they're probably wondering, what's the discrepancy? What's the difference between these two teams? Why are we losing when we know that this coach has potential to make teams successful?
And with that, the Rouser has finished, and the stadium is clearing out, and we will do the same. We want to thank everybody who joined us on the broadcast, including Connor Mockney, Jason Ruttman, Jay Sander, Elias Thomas, and Jack Bartlett. And we want to thank all the listeners who tuned in, liked, subscribed, or just listened to the game. You know, we appreciate everybody who takes time out of their day to listen. We know it's easier to watch on TV or other radio stations, so we appreciate it and have fun doing it. We'll be back for the next Gopher football game. We have Gopher hockey next week, and we might even squeeze in a volleyball game next week as well. So make sure you subscribe or follow the Radio K Sports Hour Twitter so you can get updates of when those games are being broadcasted and when they're going live. And lastly, check out that Sports Hour podcast on Tuesday evenings or on Spotify, the Sports Hour on Radio K. Thanks again for joining us here on Radio K Sports via YouTube here from Huntington Bank Stadium. I'm Trask Angel, and we will see you next week.